afternoon, everyone. The first item of business this afternoon is a debate on motion number 14956 in the name of Anne McTaggart on the National Galleries of Scotland Bill. I'd invite all members who wish to speak in this debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I call on Anne McTaggart to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the National Galleries of Scotland Bill Committee. Ms McTaggart, you have 6 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I am pleased to open the preliminary stage debate, we've not got off to a good start, on the National Galleries of the Scotland Bill, and to provide the Parliament with some background to the committee's scrutiny of the said bill. Before I do that, however, I would like to thank some members and those in particular who gave evidence to the committee and to the National Galleries, of course, all the staff that had provided and accommodated us with a visit and gave us such an interesting tour of the Scottish art collection. But lastly, my thank yous were to the committee members, the MSPs, Fiona MacLeod and Jean Urquhart, of whom you will hear speak later on in the debate. Presiding Officer, private bills propose laws that allow individuals, groups of individuals or corporate bodies to acquire powers or benefits in excess of or in conflict with the general law. This bill is the fifth private bill to be introduced in this parliamentary session, and it is the second private bill that I have worked on. The role of the committee was to consider and report on the general principles of the bill and decide whether the bill should proceed as a private bill. The bill's purpose is to facilitate the building of an extension to the Scottish National Gallery building into a small area of land which currently forms part of Princes Street Gardens. The bill has two aims. The first is to change the status of the land, which is common good land, so as to enable the City of Edinburgh Council to dispose of it to the National Galleries of Scotland without the need for court approval. The second aim is to remove the land from the gardens, thus removing the statutory restriction on the construction of permanent buildings on the land. The extension is required by the promoter of the bill, the Board of Trustees of the National Galleries of Scotland, who wish to expand and improve the design of the gallery in order to house the Scottish art collection in a more appropriate and accessible location. This project, Celebrating Scotland's Art, plans to expand the Scottish wing into Princes Street Gardens to provide an additional 500 square metres of space in which the Scottish art collection will be exhibited. The project has also includes a plan to renew the landscaped public pathway and the terrace at the garden level, aimed at improving access between the gallery, the gardens, Princes Street, the Playfair steps and the Old Town. As Andy Warhol has said, and I quote, "I think having land and not ruining it is the most beautiful art that anyone could ever want to own." The area of land in question is a small sloping embankment currently used as an area of landscaping, hence the reduction of open space in the gardens will be minimal. The promoter put forward the case that the loss of the land will be compensated by landscaping improvements to the gardens and easier access to an improved cultural facility. The committee was pleased to hear of the ongoing strong working relationship between the gallery and the various departments of the council. Michael Clark, the director of the Scottish National Gallery, explained to the committee that the reason the extension is so essential is that at the moment the space within the current Scottish National Gallery building is being used for permanent collections or exhibitions, and therefore options to rehouse the Scottish art collection are limited. We also heard that at present less than 20% of the visitors to the gallery actually get down to where the Scottish collection is situated. This is a great pity, given that the collection houses pieces of art by celebrated Scottish artists, such as Sir Henry Raeburn, Sir David Wilkie, and Peter Graham. This project would create three times the amount of space it currently devotes to the Scottish collection, and will also greatly improve the circulation throughout the building. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the committee supports the aims of the promoter to improve access to the Scottish art collection. It believes that the improvements both to the gallery space and the surrounding area will enable Scotland's art collection to be enjoyed more widely. The committee therefore recommends to the Parliament that the general principles of the National Galleries of Scotland Bill be agreed and that the bill should proceed as a private bill. Therefore, Presiding Officer, I move the motion that the Parliament agrees to the general principles of the National Galleries of Scotland Bill and agrees that it should proceed as a private bill.
Many thanks. I now call on Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop. Cabinet Secretary, you have 6 minutes or thereby, please.
Presiding Officer, I want to start by thanking Emmett Taggart, Convener of the National Galleries of Scotland Bill Committee, for her opening comments and for the work that she and other members of the committee, Fiona MacLeod and Jean Urquhart, have carried out in examining this private bill. I'm pleased to be given the opportunity to speak in this debate, not only to outline my support for the bill, but to emphasise the impact of the National Galleries of Scotland as a national and international institution of which we should be extremely proud. Under the chairmanship of Ben Thompson and the leadership of Director General Sir John Layton, the National Galleries has developed into an ambitious and forward-thinking organisation. It is one of the leading art galleries in the UK and Europe and looks after one of the world's finest collections of Western art, ranging from the Middle Ages to the present day, including, of course, the National Collection of Scottish Art. In the last 10 years, the visitor numbers to the National Galleries have increased by an outstanding 30%. 2014 was a year of record attendance with almost 2 million visitors, and this confirms the National Galleries of Scotland's status as one of Scotland's major visitor attractions and consolidates Scotland's capital as one of the top international cities for visual culture. In recent years, the National Galleries has established a truly national presence and the collection is shared widely all over this country. Artist Rooms, the collection of modern art owned and operated by the National Galleries in partnership with the Tate, has attracted 39 million visitors to 77 partners in the UK since 2009 and has brought world-class art to new audiences right across Scotland from Dumfries to Shetland. In 2014, in connection with the Commonwealth Games, the National Galleries was the initiator and key partner with Glasgow Life and Creative Scotland in Generation, a project celebrating 25 years of contemporary art in Scotland. The 60 exhibitions of over 100 artists across Scotland attracted a total of 1.3 million visitors. And objects from the National Galleries are shown all over the world as ambassadors for our art and heritage. A tour of masterpieces from the galleries in America attracted large crowds in New York, San Francisco and Fort Worth, and the galleries are currently exhibiting art from Scotland to great acclaim in Sydney, Australia. The National Gallery's intention is to continue to use this ambitious programme of major exhibitions of Scottish and international art to attract audiences and more diverse audiences and raise its national and international profile. And it's estimated that in 2015, there will be some 21 exhibitions and displays across all of the National Gallery sites and 300 education events, lectures, tours, workshops and outreach initiatives in Scotland. And this gallery's plans to redevelop the Mound complex to enhance the exhibition of their Scottish collection continue that ambition and drive for success. As you'll be aware from the remarks of the convener, this bill is a necessary step to allow the transfer of land to the galleries and to allow the development at the Mound to take place. In order to achieve this, the gallery needs to move its existing boundary wall to incorporate a 5 metre wide strip of what is currently common good land, and this is the subject of the current private bill. The promoters make the case that this modest intervention would enhance the space available for the Scottish collections and allow the introduction of daylight into these new galleries. The 5 metre strip of land that would be lost by moving the boundary would be regained at the upper level, allowing for a widening of the footpath leading to the Playfair steps, a most welcome widening of a popular pedestrian thoroughfare that quickly becomes a bottleneck during busy periods. And under the gallery's plan, sympathetic landscaping will ensure that these interventions are effectively integrated into the World Heritage setting in Princes Street Gardens, while access to this part of the gardens will be significantly enhanced. The refurbishment of the Scottish National Gallery, the flagship of our national collections, will triple the gallery's space available to show Scotland's national school, presenting not just the great historical figures, but also 20th century art, including the Scottish colourists. And under these plans, full use will be made of digital technology to make our national collection available to the widest possible public. The project aims to show Scottish art in a much more prominent way in architecturally distinguished spaces with spectacular views across the city. The newly refurbished galleries will attract an estimated additional 400,000 visitors and 770,000 digital audience interactions every year. The galleries has a track record of delivering outstanding development and refurbishment projects. Any of the members who can recall how the National Portrait Gallery looked prior to its refurbishment and who have visited since it was reopened by the former First Minister on the 1st of December 2011 will be aware of the fabulous impact that transformative project had and the many benefits it has delivered for visitors to the gallery. This project will have the same level of transformative effect, opening up the gallery's Scottish collections for the public. A forward-thinking National Galleries of Scotland seen to continue delivering an international class visitor experience is a real benefit to Scotland. When complete, this project will allow the galleries to show what might be described as the crown jewels of Scottish art in the high-quality setting that these collections deserve, and to promote Scotland's greatest art with pride to audiences from all over the world. And for this reason, Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to support the committee's recommendation to agree the bill's general principles and that the bill should proceed.
Many thanks. I now call on Claire Baker. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to contribute to this short debate this afternoon. I would like to thank the committee members for their work, though it does appear to be remarkably straightforward for this Parliament. With no objections to the proposal, it is a matter of law and process, and I have confidence that MSPs are taking forward the necessary progress for the realisation of this project. Of course, if the bill is passed, there is still a planning permission process to be sought. As a first-year student at Edinburgh University, I studied art history and I lived in Patrick Geddes Halls, which overlooks the National Galleries. And I was fortunate to study in Edinburgh with the National Galleries there on my doorstep and spent much time there at tutorials. It is our national collection and holds an impressive collection of Renaissance paintings and work up to the 1900s. In the early days of this Parliament, there was a successful campaign to buy Botticelli's The Virgin Adoring the Sleeping Christ Child, and the response to that campaign demonstrates the commitment that people have to the success of the gallery. It is also a city gallery situated in the heart of Edinburgh and frequently used by people who live, work and study here. It is an impressive collection for a small country, not least its Turner collection, which will soon be on display. It is also home to the Skating Minister, which provided inspiration for the design of this building. As the Cabinet Secretary said, visitor numbers at the gallery have been growing with a 39% increase, taking it up to 129 million visitors at the latest figures. And visitor numbers at all our museums and galleries have been growing strongly, and they are an important part of our tourist economy as well as a rich resource for our country. This development gives the gallery an opportunity to provide permanent access to more of its collection. The gallery hosts the world's largest collection of Scottish art, including works by David Wilkie, Alan Ramsay, William McTaggart, James Guthrie and Henley Rayburn. I am conscious that all of these are men, and I would very much like to welcome the Modern Scottish Women exhibition that is on just now at the National Gallery. It covers a period where an unprecedented number of Scottish women were being trained and practising as artists. And it is a special exhibition, but it's one that does include an entrance fee. And I hope the extension in gallery space will allow a greater opportunity to display the work of women artists under the free entrance scheme. The extension of gallery space would allow greater exposure of the collection of Scottish artists by tripling the available space. It will include more 20th century Scottish art, including the work of the colourists. It is right that the National Gallery are exploring ways in which to give greater access to Scottish art. There is high quality, significant work that could be enjoyed and studied by more people than is possible at present. It's also argued that additional space will give more opportunities for conservation and research. This is the second time the National Gallery has extended its footprint. The Playfair project was completed in 2004 and it improved the entrance and the environment of the gallery, which is one of Edinburgh and Scotland's key attractions. The land is common good land, as well as being subject to a statutory restriction which prohibits developing permanent buildings within the gardens. There are good reasons for this, and there must almost be caution when the status of common good land is changed. Princes Street Gardens are integral to Edinburgh and they need to be protected. But, Presiding Officer, there is a planning process, but the proposed developments do appear to me to be sensitive. There is a case for improving the landscaping around the gallery and providing more connectivity between Princes Street and the New Town and the Royal Mile and the Old Town. The current access is not ideal. The Playfair steps are not for everyone. Presiding Officer, today is not about that debate, however. It's about enabling that debate to take place. And I'm pleased to recognise the progress of the committee and wish them well in their future work.
Many thanks. I now call on Liz Smith, 4 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I straight away thank the committee and also put on record the Conservatives' support for the principles of the bill. Claire Baker has just mentioned that 12 years ago this Parliament passed the National Galleries Scotland Act, which sought to disapply the effect of Section 22 of the City of Edinburgh's District Council Order Confirmation Act 1991. To a piece of land within Edinburgh's Princes Street Gardens, and at that time, obviously, it was for the Playfair project. It was a huge undertaking by the National Galleries of Scotland, which transformed their presence on the mound by integrating the magnificent National Gallery and the renovated Royal Scottish Academy building. And I think the success is plain for all to see in terms of the way that that project has enhanced the rich arts culture in the capital city for exactly the reasons that the Cabinet Secretary set out earlier. Although I was not an MSP at that time, I very much remember these developments, and so it is a pleasure for me to speak in this debate on account of the fact that the National Galleries of Scotland are lodging another private bill, which I believe shows their commitment to continuing art and culture and education in Scotland, and I think it demonstrates their ambitions to expand their collections to make it a gallery fit for the modern capital city for many years to come. The project has a number of very impressive benefits, not least the fact that it will triple the size of the current gallery. I think when giving evidence to the committee, I thought it was very interesting that Michael Clark mentioned that similar projects undertaken by galleries in other cities around the world, such as the £45 million refit in the Tate in London, he mentioned, the renovations to the American art galleries in the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, and of course the magnificent Musée d'Orsay in Paris. So it's very fitting that another international city like Edinburgh should enjoy similar galleries for our national art. If the expansion also leads to a greater number of visitors, and the Cabinet Secretary again said just the impressive progress that has been made, then obviously there is huge financial benefit to the economy, and that can bolster the ability to preserve and enhance not only the collections, but the galleries and all that they stand for future generations. And of course the project has also the additional benefits of ensuring that there is much better access, including disabled access to the gardens and improving the landscape for that area. Given the relatively tight timetable for this project to start in 2017 and be completed by the autumn of 2018, and the fact that the consultation between the National Galleries and the City of Edinburgh Council has been ongoing for a considerable length of time, it is right that this bill encompasses all the relevant legal changes to ensure that the project can proceed as quickly as possible. So I think seeking a court order to make that change for the common good status is absolutely right. And again, can I restate the Conservatives' support for that? Moreover, I understand why both the National Galleries and the City of Edinburgh Council have explained why they were hesitant to attempt to amend the 1991 Act, given that this could have the unintended consequences of allowing further building works in the gardens. So it's very important to balance the relevant merits of this project with a desire to keep the gardens as a valuable green space within the city centre. So to conclude, may I congratulate the National Galleries and indeed the Edinburgh City Council for working together on what is a very significant project, which I think will advance Scottish art in a way that perhaps was unimaginable some decades ago. So can I thank the committee, can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her enthusiasm too. I'm sure this will be something that future generations will be very proud of in years to come.
Many thanks. And we now move to closing speeches, and I call on... I beg your pardon. I now call on Jean Urquhart. Forgive me, Ms Urquhart. 4 minutes, please.
Forgive you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I was really pleased to be part of the committee with Anne McTaggart and Fiona MacLeod. My interest was aroused, I guess, because of the words Common Good Land and National Galleries of Scotland. And I hear all the wonderful things that have been said about the content of our National Gallery. There has, however, been long criticism for a long number of years by artists and others who always felt that going in the front door of a National Gallery in the capital city of any country, not to see, or for the national art of that country not to be immediately obvious, has been a shame on us, really, because we do, and as others have said, have highlighted really the wonderful works of art that you had to plough down two stairs into a basement to see. So just to be quite kind of graphic about that, I do think that this development will make an enormous difference, and so it should. I think it's a coming of age for our own collection of Scottish artists that they should be seen. And also, I hope they will be seen, because the same gallery will still be there with a different entrance. So I'm hopeful that there will be, not that we see collections in the same rooms, but actually start to use the National Gallery with a far more emphasis on the fact that where you can find the Scottish painters. 20% of people not making their way to that particular gallery when they go into the National Gallery is something not to be proud of. But there are many bonuses from this bill, and as has already been mentioned, the very small part of Princes Street Gardens that will become part of the National Galleries of Scotland seems to me common good to common good. And that's great, but there are some other benefits. And one of them, I think, is not only the Playfair steps, which are in need of renovation for sure, and disabled access, which I understand we will have, and a realignment of some of the grass, so that I think the whole area around that part of the gallery will look quite spectacular. And finally, Presiding Officer, there is in that place a memorial to the extraordinary role that Scots played in the Spanish Civil War. And it's always been tucked away, rather like the artwork. Scotland's art collection have been tucked away in the basement of our National Gallery for too long. So too has it's not a huge memorial, but the memorial to the Spanish Civil War and those who went from Scotland to fight in it will be given more prominence and shown to better example in the new layout of the grounds. So I don't think there has been anyone who has objected to this move of common good to common good of public land becoming part of the National Galleries, and I certainly look forward to seeing the work when it's complete and seeing Scotland's artists, and indeed those who went to the Spanish Civil War, and Playfair himself, the steps, all being renovated and renewed for Scotland's interest. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And we now move, the second time of asking, to the closing speech from Fiona MacLeod on behalf of the committee, a generous 3 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And in closing this debate, can I thank all the members who have taken part in it in highlighting the exciting opportunities that this bill presents for the National Gallery of Scotland, and also the Cabinet Secretary and others for also highlighting the importance of the Scottish collection and how this will give us the ability to present it to the public in a much more dramatic and pleasing fashion. But I now have to, Presiding Officer, go on to a lot of technicalities in closing this debate, because a preliminary stage debate, as the convener mentioned in her opening remarks, The committee has to look at whether there is a need for a private bill. We have to satisfy ourselves on the necessity for a private bill. And that's what I wish to cover here, to have on the record. So there were three areas that the committee explored when looking at the necessity for a private bill. We were looking at the necessity to revoke inalienable status of this small part of Princes Street Gardens. We were also looking at the prohibition of building permanent buildings out with two schedules in the gardens. And we also looked at whether amending the 2003 Act, which was for the Playfair project, which Claire Baker mentioned, if that would have been a suitable vehicle to achieve what the promoters were looking for. So if I turn to revoking inalienable status, can I tell you that we took a lot of evidence and carefully examined and questioned those witnesses. And on that, the promoter chose a bill over going to court, which is the other way of moving from inalienable to alienable status. And they decided to do that amongst other reasons, and one that was compelling for us, was to allow for a single, shall we call it, an authorisation process for this project. And that allowed it to tie with the second area that I wish to talk about, which is the 1991 City of Edinburgh District Council Order Confirmation Act. And that's the act that limits what can be built and what can't be built within Princes Street Gardens. And at the moment, the two schedules to that act would not allow a museum or gallery extension to be built. And the reason that the promoters and the council gave for not going in and amending that 1991 Act was, as Liz Smith said, if you do that, it opens that Act up to a lot more amendment and therefore opens the gardens up to, in the future, possible more development. And that is not what this bill wanted to achieve. And then finally, the 2003 Act of this Parliament, also called the National Galleries of Scotland Act, which was to facilitate the Playfair project, we said, well, couldn't you go and amend that Act instead of bringing another Act before Parliament? But that didn't cover the inalienable to alienable status of that piece of land in the gardens, because at the time, in 2003, it was dealt with through the court process. But in this instance, going back to my first comments, in order to bring all these together in one single process, which was open and transparent to the public, our committee heard that evidence and are in agreement that this needs to be a private bill and therefore should proceed. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And that concludes the preliminary stage debate on the National Galleries of Scotland Bill. And it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is the annual debate on motion number 15031 in the name of Richard Lockhead on sea fisheries and end-year negotiations. I'd invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And Cabinet Secretary, if you are ready, now call on you to speak to and move the motion. You have 13 minutes or thereby. There's a little time in hand should you wish longer.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This year of all years feels like a particularly pivotal moment as we debate the annual fishing negotiations. And at the end of the year, it's always useful to reflect on the past year and, of course, to look ahead to future opportunities and the challenges. And at the end of this year in particular, as the next phase of the discard ban commences, we stand on the brink of what could be a generational change for the fishing industry in Scotland. We know it's said that the only thing that's constant is change, and that is certainly true of the regulatory frameworks within which fishing and marine management takes place. What hasn't changed, however, is the hardwired significance of fishing to our country. Individual livelihoods and the very social fabric of many coastal communities depend on the industry in all its different varied forms. And as the Year of Food and Drink reaches its conclusion, it is fitting that we celebrate the international success story of Scotland's seafood sector, a sector that is the cornerstone of the wider food sector's incredible success we've all witnessed over the last few years in particular. From shellfish to whitefish to mackerel, Scotland's fishermen and our seafood businesses are playing a leading role in strengthening our reputation as a producer of world-class food and drink, making Scottish seafood a prized product across the whole of the world. And the opportunities are there. Fish now accounts for almost 17% of the world population's protein intake, with per capita consumption of fish doubling from 10 kilograms in the 1960s to more than 19 today. And recently published statistics underline the economic importance of fishing to Scotland, with landings valued up by nearly a fifth last year and revenues now worth over £500 million. And as a nutritious, self-replenishing resource, seafood is a key element of food security now and into the future. And Scotland is very blessed to have such a rich fishery right on our own doorstep. Our seas are the fourth largest of core European waters and make up over 60% of the UK's waters. Around 4 tonnes of fish on average are taken from each square nautical mile of Scottish waters, compared to around 1 tonne of fish per square nautical mile on average throughout the EU waters. And all of that underlines the importance of our role as custodians of what is a very precious resource. We're borrowing that resource from our children and from their children, therefore we have a moral duty to manage it very carefully and responsibly. That's, of course, why this year's negotiations are so important, and the good news is they look promising. The scientific advice for our fish stocks, particularly our whitefish stocks, paint a very positive picture. Deputy Presiding Officer, of Scotland's top 15 whitefish stocks, we can expect increases in no less than 10. So that is great news and something we really should celebrate. But of course, we have to take a moment to give credit to the Scottish fishing industry for the transformation in our fisheries, particularly the transformation in North Sea cod. This stock, as we all know very well, used to be the altar on which the fishing industry's fortunes were sacrificed. But how far we have come. As I reflect on my time as Fisheries Minister, and I've had the privilege of being in this post since 2007, I can recall that back then we were struggling with the old common fisheries policy and cod stocks were rock bottom. We had to endure big reductions in quota and cuts to days at sea under the cod recovery plan. But despite this, the fleets redoubled their efforts to help cod stocks recover. They worked with government to implement a system of real-time closures at sea that protected the growing stock, and they fished with more selective gears and bigger mesh to allow more juvenile fish to escape and reproduce. And we developed new innovative schemes, such as the Conservation's Credit Scheme, where we awarded more time at sea in return for avoiding cod. All that hard work, that commitment, that creativity by our fishermen working with government has now produced dramatic results. North Sea cod is now over 3 times the size in terms of the size of the stock than it was in 2006. And this is reflected in the highest advised catch by the scientists since 2002, now almost 50,000 tonnes. That is a truly momentous shift. And it's astonishing to think that North Sea cod is now on a journey towards Marine Stewardship Council accreditation, something unthinkable less than a decade ago. I have to say, given these positive developments, it is of course ironic that at this year's Council, we may sadly once again have to spend energy fighting the provisions of the dysfunctional cod recovery plan, which is still in place. When we achieved the freeze and days at sea cuts in 2012, the Commission and the European Parliament objected to the freeze itself. Not so much to the freeze itself, but to the procedure that the Council used to actually achieve that. And earlier this week, the European Court of Justice ruled against the Council and annulled the 2012 regulation that gave effect to that effort freeze. However, that's in the background, and we must not allow ourselves in this Parliament to worry excessively about institutional wrangles between the institutions in Brussels. We have to focus on our national interest and the continuing success of our fishing communities.
Wrangles in Brussels, although as you well know, they sure do matter. He'll be aware that next week there are crucial talks in Copenhagen about access to mackerel involving the Faroese. Is he in a position to outline what his position is on that to Parliament this afternoon, given how important that is both to the Scottish and Shetland pelagic fleets?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it will certainly be the case, because Tavish Scott quite really highlights the importance of these talks, that we'll be ensuring that in terms of access and quota shares that Scotland gets a fair and just deal. And at the same time, we have to take into account the implications for Scotland's whitefish sector, who benefit from these talks as well as the other sectors as well. But in terms of the cod recovery plan, which I was just referring to, it is, however, good news that whilst it's still in place and it's dysfunctional, that member states now accept that it should be repealed, and indeed even the European Commission itself now accept that it should be repealed, and I call on the Commission to bring forward such a proposal as soon as possible. In the meantime, I can assure Parliament that the Scottish Government will not implement any proposals for further cuts in days at sea. But many other North Sea whitefish stocks are showing similarly encouraging trends, with healthy increases for haddock, monkfish and megrim. In the West, rockall haddock and nephrops are also enjoying increased catch advice for 2016. Again, there's challenges in some of this year's science as well, including more difficult advice for North Sea nephrops, the prawns, whiting and saithe. And in the West, the fortunes of cod and whiting remain stubbornly intractable. But we see some welcome increases in pelagic stocks, including North Sea herring and sprats, Atlanto-Scandian herring and Western horse mackerel as well. For others, briefly.
David McGregor.
Just on the point of Western herring, can you tell me the position at the moment on the EU-Norway talks with regard to the herring?
Well, I'm happy to update the member on that afterwards, because clearly there's a number of issues that are interacted that will be up for negotiations in those talks. But it is the case that Western herring is a particular challenge this year with zero catches being recommended. So therefore, as you can imagine, we've discussed that issue with the industry and are keeping a very close eye on it. But even for mackerel and blue whiting, where the advice is also less positive than perhaps the last year or two, the mackerel advice remains the third highest since 2002. Of course, none of the scientific advice has yet been translated into actual quota for 2016, and these are now what are being negotiated. And I met with the Scottish industry last week to understand their priorities and make sure we're getting our positions correct as we go into these talks. And the EU-Norway talks began in Copenhagen a couple of weeks ago and should conclude tomorrow in Bergen. And as usual, these are very crucial for Scotland, accounting for more than 50% of all our quota stock fishing opportunities. If all the scientific advice is followed at this year's negotiations, we anticipate that for whitefish, around about £95 million worth of quota will derive from the EU-Norway talks, compared to around £3 million from December's Council. The EU-Norway talks set quota for some of our most important North Sea stocks, whose management is shared with Norway, including cod, haddock, whiting, saithe and herring. It also establishes mutual access arrangements and a range of quota swaps in each other's waters that we can use to address some of the challenges we face. And as we've just discussed, next week does see the start of the EU FARO talks, where we will negotiate the terms of the agreement that provides quota and access opportunities worth around £2 million in Faroese waters for our whitefish fleet alone, as well as a refuge for many of our whitefish vessels from the restrictions of the cod recovery zone. And then the week after is the final push at the negotiations in Brussels. This year's talks are more complicated than usual because for the first time ever, we are agreeing extra quota to account for fish previously discarded. This will apply to all stocks, including the discard ban next year. And these are over and above the increases I've already mentioned. But these extra increases in terms of the quota uplifts from the discard ban will help the fleet adapt to times ahead. And whilst I very much understand the challenges we face to implement the discard bans in our waters, there's no doubt this will be, in the medium to longer term, a very positive development for the industry. The wasteful practice of throwing perfectly good fish back into the sea dead makes no sense to anyone and benefits no one. In 2005, it was estimated that 7.3 million tonnes of fish was discarded globally, the equivalent of 8% of all catches. And based on the average per capita fish consumption in Scotland, the total amount of fish discarded in 2014 could feed an extra 2 million people. That's equivalent to the population of Slovenia, for instance, just to give one example. So if we are serious about managing our natural resources, conserving fish stocks and playing a meaningful role in improving global food security, the discard ban is a no-brainer. The pelagic discard ban has now been in place for almost a year with no significant issues. But of course, I don't doubt for a second that the demersal ban, the whitefish ban, which is being phased in from the 1st of January, will be much more complex, given the highly complex and mixed fisheries we have in our own waters, with over 15 quota species swimming together. I know the Scottish fishermen are concerned about how this will all be delivered and about the impact on their businesses. And let me assure you that the challenge, although big, can be met if we all work together. There's many areas where we're pursuing a partnership approach where the government's working closely with the industry. That's proving beneficial. Most importantly, of course, we listened to the industry and worked hard with them through the regionalisation process to avoid a big bang approach in 2016 and are instead phasing in the discard bans in a pragmatic and proportioned way over the next few years. So the arrangements for 2016 are a sensible, pragmatic starting point. Saying that, we know there's still a lot of work to do. And from now until 2019, when all the bans will be in place, there'll be a process of evolution, and it's really vital that we build on the experience of this year and next year to get the latter years that will be even more challenging right. So we'll continue to be in regular contact with the skippers, the onshore sector, and everyone else. We'll have to adopt more selectivity, spatial measures, smarter use of our quota, and changing how businesses operate as well. We know a one-size-fits-all approach will not succeed, and we have to be very carefully approach this. So we have a discard steering group up and running, and they're doing a lot of good work. We'll also ensure that the European Maritime Fisheries Fund will be available to support some measures that will have to be adopted as well. And we'll continue to work with other EU member states to resolve any particular difficulties that arise over the next few years, particularly in relation to choke species, where in the mixed fishery there may be insufficient quota to cover catches of certain species, leaving our vessels unable to catch the other quota species. So we recognise fishermen alone can't fix that, and it's going to require all countries working together. There's no point one country having unfished quota if another country has to stay in port because of the discard bans. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, there's a lot to go on with, but as I said at the beginning of my speech, this is a pivotal year for Scotland's fishing communities and our fishing industry. We have the potential for a massive double benefit for Scotland's fishermen. We have rising quotas. An incredible number of our vital quotas are going to experience substantial increases for 2016. At the same time, there will be a reduction in discarding of healthy fish in our waters at the same time, and that will lead to additional benefits for fisheries conservation and leave more fish in the sea to breed for future generations. So I'm proud to represent Scotland's fishermen and will ensure that Scotland's priorities are at the forefront of the minds of my UK counterparts at the forthcoming negotiations, and we will work tirelessly in pursuit of their best interests. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on Claudia Beamish to speak to and move Amendment 15031.3. Ms Beamish, you have 9 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. I'm pleased to be speaking in the Sea Fisheries and End of Year Negotiations debate for the fourth year, not quite as long as the Cabinet Secretary. And I want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for the detailed and comprehensive account of the range of species and also the details of the forward-looking to the negotiations. I want also to say that we are able to support the Scottish Government motion today and also the Tory motion. We would like to have supported the Lib Dem amendment, but unfortunately, just due to one small word, which is substantially, in relation to quota uplift instead of sustainably, we are forced to abstain on that. At this time of the Paris Climate Summit, it is a grave concern that the world's oceans are not being discussed. And I would like to just take a step back from the negotiations themselves and highlight some concerns in relation to this. Here in Scotland, we are in some ways ahead in focusing on marine climate change, with the National Marine Plan and its pilot regionalisation, and the body of work done across the sectors. As members may be aware, in the report on policy and proposals, the first one, there was a box for peatlands, and now there is substantial information about Scotland's commitments for peatlands. In the RPP2, there was a box for blue carbon and reference to carbon sinks, and the progression is encouraging. In RPP3, I hope there will be a substantial amount on marine carbon sinks, and I hope for reassurance from the Cabinet Secretary on some of that today in his closing remarks. The twin concerns are the monitoring and addressing of the effects of climate change and the opportunities we're increasingly learning about are absolutely vital for the future, and we must make future commitments here in Scotland. I want to draw some close focus on marine climate change issues from two perspectives, changing fish stocks and fishing practices. Research into the migratory pattern of the bluefin tuna have been done by Blue Planet Society Marine Conservation. And I quote, the extent of bluefin distribution is limited by temperature, despite their advanced thermoregulatory capacity. There has been increased sightings off Ireland and Scotland for the last 4 years, and one of the possible causes being explored is the warming ocean climate, allowing tuna to exploit previously waters that were too cold previously, although the research is in its initial stages. I also heard recently from Claire Navan of Bloom Association and Pete Ritchie of the charity Nourish, who shared some challenging research with me. It is a great relief that some of the fishing practices that are practiced in other parts of the world and indeed in some European waters do not take place in Scottish waters. And one of these is deep sea bottom trawling. Research by Bloom has shown that deep water marine life has a long lifespan, late life sexual reproductivity, limited plant life for feeding, and slow repopulation, thus is vulnerable to extinction from overfishing. Destruction can be discrete, with soft coral reefs less obvious than the closer inshore reefs that we have around Scotland. And British deep water fish sequester 1 to 2 million tonnes of carbon each year. And while this research is in its initial stages, I still want to draw it to the attention of the Chamber. Can I seek reassurance from the Cabinet Secretary today that this practice is not happening around our Scottish waters, which I understand to be the case? The evidence shown of the importance of incrementally building a research base into marine ecosystems is fundamental. And I would also like to ask the Cabinet Secretary today if funding is secure for Marine Scotland and if we are sure that auditing of a future skills base for what is needed is there as well. And are the links with academic research, which is so robust, strongly bonded and nurtured by the Scottish Government? The examples of evidence of the damage caused by deep sea bottom and the fishing and the tentative findings of the changes in migratory patterns of bluefin tuna show the need for collaborations and fundings. And as all of us taking part in this debate today are keenly aware, fish do not know the boundaries of territorial waters. The stark reality of the film End of the Line, which some members may know, and the repercussions of overfishing down the species globally are certainly not lost to anyone. Yes, I will briefly.
Thanks, the member, for taking the intervention. That's 5 minutes now we are in a contribution to the debate. And I've not heard anything about the Scottish fishing industry and the end of your negotiations yet.
As I made quite clear at the beginning of my speech. I intend to move to that, and I'm actually dealing with the context within which we all have to operate globally, and I'm quite surprised that the member feels it's necessary to intervene on that basis. International collaborations are essential as well. Building on this, can the Cabinet Secretary clarify if the Scottish Government is at present contributing to any international forum or regional forums on climate change, working with different countries, either as a Scottish Government or as part of the UK? If not, would he agree today to investigate the possibilities of taking this imperative forward? Scottish Labour is clear that sustainable development is key to ensuring Scottish waters are healthy waters. Through the fusing of economic and social and environmental, we can contribute the best possible outcomes for now and for the future. The challenges this approach poses do not have simple answers, as the Cabinet Secretary has stressed. However, it is clear that through strong partnerships at all levels and a determination to work together, we are moving towards a future positive, as I would put it. Turning to the socioeconomic issues, the everyday challenges faced by the fishing industry are, of course, manifold. On the sea, in rapidly changing weathers, health and safety issues, keeping accounts, and taking forward planning decisions like any other business. Often living in fragile coastal communities, there is an additional complexity of the social structures of our communities and what underpins these: transport services, broadband access, and broader infrastructure issues. There are also pressures on the processing industry and the threat to job security, not least because of the changing pattern of catches. The development of the landing obligation, as the Cabinet Secretary says, is essential, and as the motion and amendments reflect today. I understand that the European Maritime Fisheries Fund is intended to have a broader scope than in past arrangements, and that Marine Scotland has said that it is to have a greater focus than before on measures which can support the management and protection of the marine environment. This is essential. And I also welcome the landing obligation and its gradual implementation. It is a significant step in the enhancement and preservation of our seas as a sustainable and bountiful resource. Scottish fishermen must be commended and thanked for their dedicated efforts in adapting to the discard ban so far through the last year. As we approach the next phase-in, the challenges are undeniable, and I wish the Cabinet Secretary every success in the negotiations for maximising sustainable catching opportunity as hoped for by the Scottish Fishermen's Federation. My colleague Graham Pearson will discuss implementation and monitoring further, but I do call on the Scottish Government to commit to an evaluation of a cost-effective approach to monitoring and enforcement, and I thank the SFF and the Scottish Whitefish Producers Association for their ready information and guidance. The industry, environmentalists and foodies alike will rejoice as cod stocks hit the highest catch level in recommended for 15 years, although I did listen with concern to what the Cabinet Secretary was saying about the cod recovery plan and the complications of that at the moment. Other species, as he says, show a mixed picture. In our amendment, we highlighted the need to support the implementation of the landing obligation. And can the Cabinet Minister explain specifically how the EMFF will aid a smooth transition for those communities which need this most in this complex development? And further, how widely will the fund and application process be promoted and advertised? And finally, and importantly as well, the Cabinet Secretary touched briefly on the issue of regionalisation. And I wonder if he might, in his closing remarks, say a little bit more about this, because in previous years, this has been a point of large discussion in the debate, and it would be helpful to hear somewhat of an update on that as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I now call on Jamie McGregor to speak to and move Amendment 15031.1. Mr McGregor, 6 minutes or thereby, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer. I thank all the organisations for their briefings in advance of today, and I'm pleased that many of the key fish stocks, which are important to Scotland's fishermen, are in good health. Indeed, there must be very few of us, even a couple of years back, would have believed that experts are now saying that within a decade we will have MSC-certified North Sea cod. But let me be clear that the recovery in cod and other... I'll just make a little bit of progress, if I may. And let me be clear that the recovery in cod and other fish stocks is down to the sacrifices of Scottish fishermen who have done more for conservation measures in the last 10 years than any other fishing fleet in the whole of Europe. On a personal note, I've been fisheries spokesman more often than not during four parliaments, and my recognition and respect for the calibre of the Scottish fishermen who face great dangers in bringing much-needed protein to the tables of our people has done nothing but increase, and I shall miss representing them as much as anything else I have done. But while there's some good news, I want to run through the many issues and difficulties currently facing our Scottish fishermen. The phased introduction of the discard ban in the demersal sector from the 1st of January next year, with a full ban to be in place by 2019, is a truly massive challenge. Last week, at a briefing in this Parliament, Mike Park of the Scottish Whitefish Producers Association described it as an approaching storm with the potential to go very badly wrong, especially midpoint in the transition period. Now, Ross Dougal, who I saw today at the European Committee of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, has described it as a potential economic disaster for the Scottish fleet and subsequently the onshore processing sector industry. The problems of choke species, that means the point where an individual vessel runs out of its lowest quota in the mix and has to stop fishing altogether, and how the landing obligation copes with species with a zero total allowable catch, are still really to be addressed. All industry stakeholders agree that a quota uplift is crucial to allowing demersal fishermen to manage the move towards a discard ban. But we believe that this in itself will simply not be enough, and the Scottish Government needs to give the industry more support to meet the landing obligation, especially in small ports where there are no processing facilities nearby. And my colleague Ian Duncan, MEP, has been at the forefront of arguing this case, making the point that even at this late stage, funding should be made available, especially to our smaller and remoter ports, such as Maleg, to help with the adaption of what will be a transformation in the way demersal fishermen go about their business, and the additional burdens of disposing of fish once it is shoreside, including the storage and the transportation of the fish that cannot be sold. There's £107 million, I think, in the EU Maritime Fund. Maybe some of that could be used for that. I'm also calling on the Scottish Government to do everything in its power to ensure that there is a level playing field across all demersal fleets fishing in the EU waters in terms of compliance and of monitoring. And I'm pleased that WWF Scotland, in their briefing for today, make that point as well. It would be unacceptable if our demersal fishermen were subject to extra monitoring controls while other fleets were not. Our fishermen must not be placed at a competitive disadvantage to anybody else. In the pelagic sector, that's herrings and mackerel, I support Scotland's mackerel fishermen and processors who want to see a reduction in the current access arrangements for Faroese fishermen catching mackerel in Scottish waters. A recently published report by Seafish has found that these current arrangements are heavily skewed in favour of the Faroese, and Scottish pelagic fishermen and processors rightly want to see a more equitable agreement between the EU and the Faroes. Our processing sector is under real pressure due to the fact that the current arrangement allows the Faroese to catch over £40 million worth of very high quality mackerel in Scottish waters, which is being sold into the same markets as the mackerel from our own processors. Certainly, yes.
Richard Lockhead.
I know there's, I thank Jamie McGregor for giving way, and I realise there's some heated debate around this issue, but will he accept that Faroese access to Scottish waters was reduced from 42% in 2010 to 30% in 2015, and it's really important we don't selectively quote different figures?
Jamie McGregor.
Well, I suspect that is the truth, but if you think of what they caught before 2005, it's a huge impact on our industry now. Another key issue for the pelagic sector is the IC's advice for a zero TAC for Western herring. The Pelagic Advisory Council has proposed positive initial plans to rebuild this stock and improve the quality of the scientific data on it. But to do this, they need a quota to be able to progress the scientific programme. This is a hugely important issue for pelagic fishermen, and I hope the Cabinet Secretary will push for this at the December Council. And before closing, Presiding Officer, I must again voice my support for the West Coast fishermen continuing to campaign against the proposed MPAs on the West Coast, or some of the effects of what they might be. The fishermen are clear they're not opposed to MPAs in principle, but the current proposals, which do not reflect agreements they believe they reached in consultations, are disproportionate and go beyond the protection of specific marine features which MPAs are designed to safeguard. And I remain concerned at the potential impact of MPAs on the livelihoods of individual West Coast fishermen and the processors who depend on their catch. And there are real safety issues here. For example, in relation to the MPAs in the Small Isles and Westeros, where we still have mobile nephrops trawlers, small ones, and we're cutting off areas that have hitherto been fished, could lead to fishermen having to work in more dangerous waters or increasing pressure on other grounds, or eventually just tying up their boats altogether. And none of these options is attractive. I continue to urge the Cabinet Secretary to take on board the fishermen's concerns. Many fragile communities up and down the West Coast are dependent on these local fishing jobs and income. I move the amendment in my name.
Thanks so much. I now call on Tavish Scott to speak to and move Amendment 15031.2. Mr Scott, 6 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And if this is Jamie McGregor's last speech in Parliament on fisheries, we'll all miss that. Richard Locke and I might remember, and Jamie will certainly remember, the sketches that Rad McNeill, then the Scotsman, used to write about fisheries debates, going right back to the early days. And John Scott will remember those as well. As well. And Mr McGregor used to be called Mr Prawn, if I remember rightly, in those sketches, which was an outrageous slur on his character. But actually, he's been a doughty fighter for the industry over the years, to whoever has been taking the Cabinet Secretary's seat in these annual debates. There are a couple of broad questions I'd like to just address this afternoon, Presiding Officer, and the first is around just the importance of fishing to fishing communities, to the islands, to the west coast, as we've just heard, to the northeast, to the Cabinet Secretary's own part of Scotland. Not just the boats themselves, the skippers, the men, but the shoreside businesses, which sometimes don't get the same airing, the logistics support, the men and women who run haulage businesses across Scotland, all of whom contribute to the wider economic impact and therefore social impact of an enormously important Scottish industry. And there are these kind of debates when occasionally it's right to ask, do the powers that be get that? Do the powers that be in Europe absolutely understand that point? And the acid test of this, as the industry now see it, and certainly a view I share, is how any country will implement the discard ban. Get it wrong, and countries who have a whitefish industry at this time will not have one in the future. Now, Angus MacDonald organised a really good meeting last week, and I'm grateful to him for that. And Mike Parker, has already been mentioned, said at that parliamentary discussion that the discard ban regulations drawn up by the European Commission were the worst piece of law ever written in Brussels. Well, probably come up with a few others, to be honest, over the years. And Mr Lockhead rightly raised the cod recovery plan. That was a pretty appalling piece of drafting as well. But no matter, it was a serious point, and it's a concern that's mirrored by the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, the Shetland Fishermen's Association, and any skipper or fisherman that you care to meet. Certainly, and I do believe it's important that we reflect on the industry concerns on that.
Give it to Stuart Stevenson. Stuart Stevenson.
The member referenced the Scottish Fishermen's Federation's concern. Is he aware of any briefing from the SFF? I've as yet had zero contact on the subject from the SFF, and I know that other colleagues are in exactly the same position. I would use the opportunity to urge them to engage with members, which clearly they're currently not doing.
Tavish Scott.
Well, all I can really say to Mr. Stevenson is I phoned up Bertie Armstrong and asked him. And I went and met the Shetland Fishermen's Association on Monday. I would assume a member like Bertie Armstrong, a member like Stuart Stevenson, who's very familiar with the industry, indeed being a former minister, quite capable of running along to their office in Aberdeen and meeting them. So it's up to him how he engages with the industry.
Please.
I certainly don't have any problems on that front myself, and would regularly speak to Bertie Armstrong, who I think does an admirable job representing fishermen right across Scotland. Presiding Officer, what is important about fisheries management is that it should not be an ideological crusade. It either works or it does not. And as other members have already pointed out, indeed the Minister rightly pointed out as well, for European policy to stop any fish being thrown over the side of a vessel has to work in a practical sense. Now that can work where there is no bycatch, mackerel and herring shoal, so they will be caught without other species. But the basis of Scotland's North Sea and West Coast whitefish fishery is that boats catch more than one species at one time, many more. So can an EU-wide discard ban work in a mixed whitefish fishery? And that is why my amendment highlights the importance, not just of 2016, but the next 3 years in terms of the implementation being right. The interpretation of these regulations must be sensitive, appropriate, and it must work. The industry has highlighted, the Cabinet Secretary rightly recognised this, the danger of choke species. But if government get that interpretation wrong, then ministers will face the unenviable task of having the fleet tied up because of the lack of just one species in a mixed fishery. That is the reality of the discard ban, not the rhetoric, not the wonderful language about how wonderful it all might be, but the reality of what that could then mean. At the EU December Council, quotas for the stocks affected in 2016, principally haddock and prawns, must be large enough to cope with that discard ban. That's why my motion It uses the word substantially, and I can't see why anyone would be against that. Indeed, the Cabinet Secretary will probably in his wind-up rightly point to the increases there are going to be for a number of those species, which are very large indeed, and that is helpful. So there we are, that's the reality of it. But the other point that I want to reflect with the Cabinet Secretary is that Shetland's fleet, and they will not be alone, will only catch two-thirds of this year's haddock quota. They are worried, as I know Scottish buyers and processors are across the country, by a glut on the market and therefore a collapse in price. And that is, as usual, the dichotomy that that market faces. Scotland cannot, and Mr McGregor made this point rightly, Scotland cannot and must not get ahead of itself on implementing this discard ban. No other EU fishing nation will be doing that. Fishermen from the Baltic to the Mediterranean are as worried as our fishermen as to how this is going to work in practice. So the Minister was right to say that a discard ban must be implemented consistently across EU waters, and that too with enforcement and compliance. I certainly bow to Graham Pearson's knowledge about enforcement and compliance, but I hope he'd take the point that, again, we cannot have circumstances where our boats are enforced in one way and yet our fishermen then see a Spanish trawler, a French or a Dutch trawler steaming by and not seeing the same level of enforcement or indeed compliance. The outrage felt by fishermen, our fishermen, over the actions of the Faroese pelagic fleet in Scottish waters or indeed Spanish gill netters, a matter I've raised with the Cabinet Secretary and I'm grateful for his responses. Spanish gill netters and their aggressive behaviour west of Shetland should be warning enough. So in between 2016 and 19, this must be a period where the discard ban is fair, seen to be fair, and fairly monitored. Now, the omens, as the Minister says, are reasonable for Christmas, indeed positive for Christmas, and that is good news for all, and I strongly welcome that. But next week's negotiations in Copenhagen on access to mackerel quota are important to the industry. Ian Gatt said today, the pelagic industry said today that they are looking to demand an urgent rethink of the political deal which allows Faroe to catch a third of its quota, mackerel quota, that's 40,000 tonnes, in EU waters. And I'm grateful to the Minister for recognising that point and being prepared to make that case. He's right, of course he's right, that our whitefish industry benefits from some counterbalance to that, but it is that is a small part of it. There's not many boats from Lerwick steaming up to Faroese waters to access that, but they see Faroese whitefish and indeed pelagic boats in our Scottish waters. So that must be the balance that I'm sure he and his officials will be seeking to get. Two final points, if I may, Presiding Officer. The first is on investment in fisheries science. I appreciate the Minister is very strong on the need for stock-deficient species to have the right kind of scientific support, and I hope he wins the internal funding battles that no doubt are going on the spending review to ensure that fisheries science is maintained. And the final point, Presiding Officer, is to ensure that in his quota consultation, which is ongoing at this time, the government make the right decisions, conscious of the unknown consequences of the discard ban and how important it is for the Scottish whitefish industry to have flexibility, certainty and, crucially, banking confidence in the decisions they make over quota swaps, quota leasing and quota purchase. And I would suggest to the Cabinet Secretary that he might wish to be pretty cautious of any change in this area that would be damaging to our industry at this time of incredible uncertainty caused by the introduction of the European discard ban. These are important matters. We wish him well in his deliberations and his negotiations, and we all hope that he comes back with a deal that will help the Scottish industry in 2016.
Thank you very much. We now turn to the open debate. Speeches of 6 minutes, please. Angus MacDonald to be followed by Graham Pearson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's that time of year again where we get that deja vu feeling. And we're back once more at the fishing negotiations debate. Every year, the UK fisheries negotiations at the EU are watched closely by fishermen around the country as policy develops, which will ultimately govern their livelihood. Sweeping regulations such as the landing obligation and the tack quotas are handed down from Brussels to our Scottish shores, where they directly affect the business of our Scottish vessels and fishermen, with the knock-on effects to our processing and haulage sectors. However, as we've heard from the Cabinet Secretary already this afternoon, there's a much more positive outlook this year, not least the large increase in cod stocks and the forthcoming rising quotas. Scotland's relationship with the European Commission's Department of Maritime Affairs and Fisheries has, of course, been complex over the years. However, the healthy relationship, which reflects Scotland's prominent role in North Sea and North Atlantic fisheries, is welcome. Just last month, the Commission rightly sympathised with British and Irish fishermen in abandoning a proposal to adopt a blanket drift net ban. The ban, which was an attempt to address abusive large-scale practices in the Mediterranean, would have jeopardised the livelihood of thousands of small-scale fishermen in Scotland and around the UK, where drift net fishing is practised responsibly on a seasonal basis. By instead opting for regional regulation, the Commission allowed for greater flexibility and can appropriately address issues that are unique to different fisheries and environments. This is an approach that should be extended to other areas of their policy. The European Commission's landing obligation, which began this year with pelagic fisheries and, as we know, will be phased in through all TAC species by 2019, is one example of a blanket policy that has had negative ramifications beyond the immediate good the policy intended. The discards ban will ban all fishermen in EU waters from discarding any or all of their catch when it's fully implemented by 2019. And in an attempt to remedy the shortcomings of the TAC quota system, which perversely incentivised fishermen to discard species, the European Commission has now enacted another policy with its own set of adverse consequences. Just last week, I was delighted to host and chair a WWF briefing on implementing the discards ban in Scotland, which I was pleased the Cabinet Secretary was able to attend, which touched on the well-intentioned motivations for the ban to curb wasteful practices, as well as the adverse consequences associated with its implementation. The total allowable catch quota system was rightly guided in its motivation to ensure the sustainability of our fisheries. However, in an effort to comply with the legislation, fishermen discarded catches that violated the quota, and discarding occurred for a variety of reasons that we're all aware of. The central issue is that the Commission did not address these motivations for discarding. Rather, they treated the symptom, i.e. discarding, instead of the core issues that are caused by the Commission's own TAC quota policy. However, we are where we are, and the Scottish Government, along with Marine Scotland, has produced guidance for fishermen on disposing of undersized catches, which will now have to be landed, as well as managing quota and effort under the landing obligation. The TAC quota, when coupled with the discards ban, leave fishermen in a difficult scenario as they try to meet the obligations presented by both policies. And in particular, the emergence of choke species will inhibit fishermen to meet their quotas on certain species while avoiding exceeding their quota on others. And as Scottish fishermen operate in a mixed fishery, where multiple species of fish overlap in a single area, the issue of bycatch arises as fishermen seek one species but may also trap another in their catch unintentionally. The North Sea Advisory Council itself reported that choke species may have a strong negative effect upon fishing businesses. Potentially large quantities of quota could remain uncaught, and choke species pose a threat to the economic viability of fishing businesses. Even using various policy instruments such as quota uplift, de minimis discard allowances, interspecies flexibility and survivability exemptions, it will be difficult to mitigate the negative effects on revenue that unfilled quotas will have. But clearly we'll have to wait and see. The other problem posed by the landing obligation is ensuring compliance and enforcement. Traditional methods of enforcement are limited in that they only deter non-compliance while they are in the vicinity of the vessel, which encompasses a small percentage of the vessel's fishing effort, or they rely on self-reporting. A recent WWF report asserted that remote control monitoring coupled with closed-circuit TV would be the most efficient means of monitoring compliance. This REM system with CCTV would provide a continuous monitoring presence and high-quality evidence in addition to being economically viable when compared with traditional methods. However, it would be unfair to subject Scottish fishermen to this intense level of monitoring if other boats from other nations were not subject to the same measures, as Tavish Scott's already alluded to. So in the interest of a level playing field, which is an issue that Mike Park brought up last week, monitoring and enforcement legislation must be as universal as a discard ban that necessitated these laws. Scottish fishermen should be commended, though, on their proactive approach to reducing discards and pursuing sustainability, as many have adopted more selective gear to reduce bycatch and strategies such as spatial management and seasonal closures to ensure sustainable stocks. Finally, as always, time's running out, so finally I would like to wish the Cabinet Secretary and Scottish Government officials well in their upcoming negotiations in Brussels. The recommendations from the ICES, which has proposed increases to many of Scotland's key stocks, are encouraging, and expect other nations present at the negotiations to share the viewpoint that sustainable fisheries are desirable in accordance with the scientific recommendations. So, as Scotland lands 80% of fish caught in British waters and Europe's longest-serving fisheries minister is our very own Richard Lochhead, it's my hope that Westminster sees the good logic in allowing Scotland to lead the UK voice in the upcoming negotiations, as opposed to the totally unacceptable situation we saw last year when the unelected Lord Rupert Ponsonby, 7th Baron de Mauley, represented the UK Government on a crucial discussion on the issue of fish discards.
You must draw to a close, please.
I wish the Cabinet Secretary and his officials well. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on Graeme Pearson, to be followed by Christian Allard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. First of all, can I say that it's pleasing to hear of the many positive developments commented on by the Cabinet Secretary in relation to this area of activity. Second, in reply to Stuart Stevenson's observations about Scottish Fishermen's Federation, I have to say, as a novice in this area myself, I make contact with Bertie Armstrong, who's currently in Bergen, representing the Scottish Fishermen's Federation. And he was very generous to me in terms of the advice and briefing that he gave me in these past days in relation to our current debate. The Cabinet Secretary indicated in his introduction that the fishing industry is worth around £500 million per annum to the Scottish economy. In addition, in a region of 5,000 people rely on the industry for their employment. The fishing fields around Scotland are acknowledged as amongst the best in the world, and the fish caught in these fields are recognised as both healthy and tasty in their provision, and thereby creating a demand for the future. Catches from our seas are devoured by people from across Europe and indeed further afield. So Tavish Scott's points are well made in terms of the industry's import to not only the communities that he represents, but to the entire population of Scotland. This debate, therefore, provides an opportunity for Parliament to feed into the discussions regarding the future development of a vitally important element to Scotland's national interest. It is also an opportunity to thank all of those who are involved in the fishing industry, but particularly to those who risk their lives to provide the very fish that we eat. The new options for policy we debate today seem to me, by implication, to acknowledge two vital issues. One, the comprehensive difficulties that the Cabinet Secretary and others face in balancing the competing needs that have been expressed across the chamber this afternoon. And second, probably the most important element, the development of operational guidance on the basis of the regulations which emanate from the common fisheries policies that are agreed, will necessarily rely on the goodwill of everyone who operates in this area, the goodwill of those in the industry across Scotland. I am grateful for the various briefings that I received before today's debate, particularly from WWF and my conversations with the Federation. In speaking to Bertie Armstrong, it's apparent that Scottish fishermen, and it is exclusively men who operate in the seas from Scottish harbours currently, it's clear that these men want to ensure that their industry maintains good health and contributes to the environmental well-being of our seas. Enforcement of the regulations emanating from the common fisheries policy, particularly in relation to discards and catches, will be the responsibility of Marine Scotland to ensure compliance. And whilst I'm advised that additional resources would always be welcomed by any department, Marine Scotland are highly thought of across the industry. Additionally, the introduction of the technical surveillance that have been mentioned around the chamber this afternoon is a vital part of monitoring the way in which catches are achieved across our seas. However, it would be the wrong step to deliver the overburdening of our fleets with surveillance where they are economically disadvantaged in competition with other fleets across Europe. In that connection, therefore, Europe must ensure that the approach is a standard approach across Europe, and fishing fleets from every nation respect and reflect the efforts that are being made in the name of Europe. Where the efforts of those involved in the industry fail, we will see the development of illegal practices, such as, unfortunately, the recent blackfish scandals that resulted in criminal prosecutions being mounted, or alternatively, our fleets being disadvantaged as they try to maintain their respect for the regulations that are put in place. Hence, our efforts to get things both right and to get them practical are important. And behind that, the essential cooperation of all those involved, both from the point of view of environmental protection and the industry itself, is absolutely kernel to taking things forward. Others in this chamber have a more direct involvement in these issues and have spoken with some wisdom in respect of the specific needs that arise when protecting the environment. Scotland's voice, I am advised, plays an influential part in the development of European Common Fisheries Policy. We have the Inshore Fisheries Group, the Inshore Fisheries Management and Conservation Group, Fisheries Management and Conservation Group, and the Scottish Discard Steering Group. All of these groups feed in with the knowledge of what is required for the future. I can only hope that the Cabinet Secretary will continue to listen to the advice that he receives from across this industry, and that he reflects that knowledge to ensure that Scotland not only maintains an economically viable industry, but protects our environment for children in the future.
I'm obliged. Christian Allard, to be followed by Margaret McDougall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me start by reminding the Chamber that I worked 30 years in the Scottish fishing industry before to start a new career, this one. One with a lot less challenges and a lot less dangers, that I hope we can all agree on. I'm honoured to represent the many fishing communities in the North East since May 2013. I do feel that we in this chamber do not always give credit, or as much credit as we could, to an industry that has served Scotland for so long. Let's take an example. We heard today and for many weeks about the desperate state of our steel industry and the 400 jobs which are at risk between the communities of Motherwell and Thomaslang. We heard a lot about this iconic industry, which is the steel industry. I still have to hear any contribution this afternoon saying that the fishing industry is an iconic industry for Scotland. And if you talk about job at risk, there are more than 600 jobs at risk across only one small community in the northeast, in Fraserburgh. 2 years ago, in the government annual sea fisheries and end year negotiations debate, I made a call for more common sense and flexibility when dealing with the discards of spare dogs. Last year, I made a similar call to address the problem of closures of the skates and rays fisheries in the northeast and west of Scotland. There is going to be a lot more bycatch landing of these species next year. I know the Cabinet Secretary has worked hard to help the commercialisation of bycatch the last few years. Can I ask him to redouble his efforts in making sure that this fantastic food is not wasted any longer? Presiding Officer, food waste is our next biggest challenge. Let's start here. Let's not wait for some TV chef to ask consumers to choose imported food instead of our locally produced seafood. And as this year, we are celebrating the increase of many of Scotland's key stocks, including North Sea cod, which is at the highest level in a decade. Mind you, skippers knew this for a decade. It took us a long time in the chamber to acknowledge the fact there are many more fish in our seas. Thanks to the hard work of our fishermen, the resilience of our fish processors, and the actions of this Cabinet Secretary, the most experienced fishing minister in the EU. This is why the Smith Commission was very clear when it said that Scottish Government representation of the UK to the European Union can be achieved by presuming that a devolved administration minister can speak on behalf of the UK at a meeting of the Council of Ministers, according to an agreed UK negotiation line, where the devolved administration minister holds a predominant policy interest across the UK, and where the relevant lead UK government minister is unable to attend all or part of a meeting. No more lords representing the Scottish fishing industry, presiding officer. I would wait before to celebrate. Time will tell if the voice of the most experienced fishing minister in Europe can be discarded and replaced by an unelected lord with no previous experience whatsoever in fishing. It must always be the case that the most appropriate person takes the chair and speaks. Because the future is bright for the industry. 2016 will prove a milestone for Scottish fishing with the launch of the ban on discards for whitefish and prawn stocks. The discard ban is indeed a no-brainer, Cabinet Secretary. It is a challenge in our waters with mixed fisheries, and it's also a fantastic opportunity for our fishermen and fish processors to increase Scottish fish share of the seafood market, both at home and abroad. Presiding Officer, I agree with the Cabinet Secretary. We must focus all our efforts on our national interest and the continuing success of our Scottish fishing communities. I did not receive a briefing, like Stuart Stevenson said, for this debate from many organisations, but I usually get one. I did get one last year from the Scottish Pelagic Processors Association, but I met Jan Gatt and Jan McFadden a few weeks ago, and I congratulated them for the way the pelagic sector, fishermen and processors worked to tackle successfully the discard ban, which was in force earlier this January, and the Russian food embargo. The SFF, the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, must be delighted with our work, Cabinet Secretary, because I didn't get any briefing. I know some of us said they asked for one and they got one. I'm not in a habit to disturb Mr. Bertie Armstrong when he's on his way to travel the world. I just thought that the SFF, with the amount of funding that they have, which matches a lot of NGOs' funding, could just send the briefing to everybody. It will be such easier, and it makes life a lot easier for themselves. So it's maybe a proposal that we could take to Bertie Armstrong and Ross de Gaulle. The WWF has provided one of their briefings. They always do, but I won't talk about it. I will let Labour to talk about WWF, but I've seen that Jamie McGregor was really to be the voice of the WWF today, so I will let that to the Tories to talk about them. And I share the Cabinet Secretary's frustration that the UK government has denied Scotland a say over the seafood levy raising powers of sea fish thus far. He's right. This was one of the key recommendations of the Smith Commission. The UK government must reconsider. Full devolution of seafood levies has to happen now. And if it doesn't happen, sea fish maybe have no future in Scotland. In this Parliament, I am delighted that the Devolution Future Powers Committee made this point in the report in May. The committee added also that it is important that Scotland has the ability to introduce an EU-recognised Made in Scotland label. This label is a very, very important label. I heard something about the haulage industry from a couple of members, David Scott and Angus MacDonald, and I'd love to remind the Cabinet Secretary the problem in Calais, and I will urge the Cabinet Secretary on his way to Brussels maybe to stop in Calais and give support to our haulage drivers there who get stuck from time to time. In conclusion, I would like to make a call to the public gallery and others across Scotland. We must put all pressure on our retailers to put Scottish fish on their shelves like never before. If food waste is on the agenda for the UK media in 2016, let's welcome the ending of this card, and it must be an opportunity to commercialise at home and abroad this extra landing, particularly the landing of bycatch species. Buy and eat Scottish fish is my message to consumers. Ask retailers to put Scottish fish on the menu. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I must ask members to keep to 6 minutes just over. I don't have an awful lot of time in hand. Margaret McDougall to be followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I always do at the start of debates on our fishing industry, I'd like to pay tribute to all of Scotland's fishermen who risk their lives on a daily basis, braving the conditions of the sea to bring us high-quality, fresh fish. But the seas are not the only challenges our fishermen face. Recently, there's been the struggling economic climate and the need to find new and emerging markets due to the Russian trade sanctions. In 2013, Russia took 18% of the UK total mackerel export market. However, since those sanctions, Nigeria has now become the biggest export market, taking 20% of the UK mackerel market in 2014. And there's also been significant growth in markets in both Netherlands and China. So I'm delighted to see that despite tough times, our fishing industry has managed to adapt and survive. While I'm on the topic of the mackerel and having raised it in previous debates on fishing, I'm happy to hear that the mackerel dispute, which was about the overfishing of mackerel stock by Iceland and the Faroes and led to a proposed decrease in the total allowable catch for Scottish fishermen, has finally been resolved. Talks between the EU, Norway and the Faroe Islands reached a solution by agreeing a 15% reduction in mackerel quotas. In practice, this means the total allowable catch in 2016 will be 10% higher than 5 years ago. This is good news, as mackerel is still Scotland's most valuable fish and is expected to be worth £130 million in 2016. Higher quotas for mackerel and other fish stocks are clearly good news for our fishing industry. However, we must ensure we strike the right balance between ensuring economic growth within the sector and promoting sustainability. Developing sustainable fisheries is essential not only to the future of the Scottish fishing industry, but also to protect our fragile fishing and coastal communities and the wider seafood sector and the protection of our seas. Creating a fully sustainable fishing industry is no easy task, but we are making progress. Currently, just over 50% of North Sea fishing stock is being sustainably managed. However, in my area, the West of Scotland, progress has not been so healthy because there has been overfishing of small fish. This is disappointing, as the West of Scotland used to be one of Scotland's most productive fishing areas. So it's clear that while some progress is being made, we still have a long way to go. This could be tackled, I suggest, by achieving effective implementation of the discard ban, fishing at sustainable levels, and helping to deliver a good environmental status while retaining a profitable and sustainable fishing industry. Quotas and the discard ban, which I just mentioned, due to be phased in from 2016, will go some way to help. However, before the ban is brought in, I would suggest the Scottish Government listens to the calls from WWF, who are asking that all parties develop a strategy for the implementation and cost-effective monitoring of the discard ban in Scotland. We need more hard data on our fishing industry, and we should ensure that proper monitoring is introduced, not only for discard, but for quotas as well. I'm happy to take a short intervention.
Christian Allard.
Thank you very much, Madam Member, for taking a short intervention. It's just about WWF. I just pointed out to them last week what will be a playing field will be for them to make sure they are a worldwide organisation, that they'll push other fisheries in other countries to have the same kind of restriction that we have here in Scotland.
Margaret McDougall.
Absolutely agree that this has got to be Europe-wide. If we get the discard ban right, WWF estimate that it could prevent 25,000 tonnes of fish being thrown back into the sea in Scotland alone. However, if we don't get it right, it will just carry additional risks, creating further problems for Scottish fishermen. While some Scottish vessels have adopted selective measures in order to minimise unwanted catches, many still haven't been able to do so. With this in mind, does the Scottish Government envisage the new European Maritime and Fisheries Fund being sufficient to supporting the transition where needed? I'm also curious to know whether the Scottish Government has carried out any assessments into the use of remote electronic monitoring to the monitor of disregard. WWF's research indicated that this would be the easiest and most cost-effective way to monitor discards, gather data and promote best practice. However, for it to be fully effective, as many have mentioned earlier in the Chamber, it would have to be adopted across the EU rather than just Scotland or indeed UK. Effective monitoring and better data collection will allow us to take an informed scientific approach and also increase the openness and transparency of our industry. However, to be able to adopt full evidence-based decisions,
we need to consider spending more on marine research. Funding on research is vital to support our sustainable goals, whether this be through Marine Scotland, non-governmental organisations, or indeed working with Scottish fishermen. In addition to this, further research will allow our sector to be more adaptable and flexible, allowing it to react better to the changing environment. To conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, I welcome the progress that this has made so far. I'm pleased that the mackerel dispute has finally been resolved, that quotas are increasing due to good management, and that we have managed to break into new and emerging markets. Beyond this, we need to get better at monitoring and data collection and ensure Scottish fishermen are ready to meet the requirements of the discard ban. We must keep up the momentum and start planning for the future now to ensure the industry remains profitable, sustainable and mindful of biodiversity. Thank you.
Many thanks. And I have to ask members to keep to their 6 minutes, please. Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Roderick Campbell.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I think it's fair to say our attachment to the fishing industry is in part emotional. The occupation of being a fisherman, besides its biblical connections, is an occupation that is one of the earliest identified occupations that the human race got itself involved in. And of course, today, the fishing industry survives as one of the last hunter-gatherer industries. So it speaks to something quite deep. And of course, that places special obligations, responsibilities, duties and difficulties in the way of the successful prosecution of that trade, because the stock is much less managed than sheep on a farm, cows on a farm, crops that are sown. And I think our fishermen are absolutely to be commended for the way in which they have risen to the challenge of stock management, often in the face of total misunderstandings of science, totally ineffective and uninterpretable regulation, but nonetheless our fishermen have found a way to rebuild an industry. Stocks of cod at three times the level they were in the relatively recent past, a valuable stock that's exploited. Now, I just cannot speak in a fisheries debate without referring to the estimable Jamie McGrigger. When I spoke first in a fishing debate in June 2001, a single day after I was sworn into this parliament, Jamie was there. He wasn't me alone. There were other, well, no, looking around the chamber, maybe it was just him. And even though I seldom find myself in the position of agreeing with everything Jamie says, I always listen with close attention, if only to know what the contrary arguments are. And if I may speak directly to Jamie rather than through the chair, I say to him on behalf of myself, and I suspect many others, we shall miss you, Jamie, for your wit, your humour and your engagement in this very important issue. I hope your successor is not nearly so successful on the Tory benches as you have been, but that's a political comment. Now, it's worth just expanding that point, saying, of course, the fact that we might be in different political parties, people here, does not mean we can't make common cause and have friendships. And in fact, the fisherman who stood against me at the 2011 election for the Conservative cause in Bamshire and Buchan Coast is somebody I get on with extremely well. And we have secret assignations under cover of darkness. When I managed to get most of the cod roe that he's landed, because that is absolutely my favourite seafood out of our sea. And I'm going to work to keep that relationship going extremely well. Now, we have an issue, not just in catching fish and the regimes surrounding that, but also in fish consumption. Basically, at the moment, it's pretty static. We haven't seen much increase in fish consumption, despite the fact that our processing and catching industries continue to grow and become a more valuable component of our economy. And I think that's an issue to which we have to turn. There have been other debates in other places where we've referred to sea fish, the UK, and I think we've got to keep an eye on that. The marine protected areas is a subject which, when I was a minister, was something I was tangentially involved in. I have to say, for the East Coast fishermen, it doesn't seem to have been quite the issue it has been for the West Coast and the small communities. I understand that. I think I would very much welcome, frankly, some more targeted and specific information about that. Now, speaking about information, last met Roddy McCall, the Secretary of the Fishermen's Association Limited, on a train, and we had an excellent discussion. And I'm very much obliged to Fal for the 16-page newsletter that arrived in my inbox this week, covering a wide range of subjects. I won't pretend I agree with every word that's written in Fal's newsletter, but that will not come as news to Fal or Roddy McCall or Tom Hay, my constituent, or others. But I think there are some very good things in there, in particular drawing attention to the prospect, the imminent prospect, of our cod stocks being awarded MSC status. And I think that's a huge potential step forward, and one which will rebuild consumer attitudes to North Sea cod caught by our fishermen. But much of the comment, I may say, about lack of sustainability has been ill-informed and inappropriate. So I certainly hope that we see that moving forward in early course. Now, fishing, of course, doesn't stand alone. And in my concluding remarks, Presiding Officer, I just say, when we saw shrinkage of the fleet, we saw butchers closing in rural Banffshire because they were supplying food to boats. And that's replicated across a whole ecology of the economy that's dependent on sea fishing. When we stopped dumping sewage at sea, we saw a reduction in seabird populations. I hope when we see reduction in dumping of fish in the sea, we're monitoring what happens there. And by the way, if the SFF want to meet me, give me an invitation, I'm entirely happy to do so. We can kiss and make up any time you like, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I now call Roderick Campbell to be followed by David Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's always a difficult task to follow Stuart Stevenson, but I'll do my best. I speak in this debate with expectation, but also to some extent with some apprehension for 2016. 2016 will be an important year for the Scottish fishing industry, and all involved are tentatively looking forward to January, when the long-awaited discard ban for whitefish and shellfish, in particular prawns, is due to commence. It's worth remembering that fish conservation is a reserved matter to the European Union, which does not feature in the UK government's current renegotiating agenda. And we heard this morning at the European and External Affairs Committee from Ross Dougal of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation that even if the UK or Scotland were to leave the EU, while that might add additional complexity to negotiations in the North Sea, it was likely that there would be continued regard to the advice of the International Council for the Exploration of the Seas, a very important body. Presiding Officer, there are positives. The scientific community are advising that stocks are on the increase, and with fishing revenues that are currently worth over £500 million, there is certainly much to celebrate. Stocks of haddock are set to increase by at least 30%, and monkfish are advised to rise by 20%. Good news indeed. In addition, the fact, of course, that there was a mackerel agreement reached in October, allowing a total allowable catch for 2016 to be 10% higher than 5 years ago, is a plus. And in the discards briefing meeting, which was held last week, which has been referred to earlier on, my feeling was of an increasingly optimistic outlook. However, much reference was made at that meeting to the need for a level playing field that is required in order for continued success and the prosperity of our own fleet. WWF, in their briefing, acknowledged that the implementation of the discards ban represents one of the biggest operational shifts in European fisheries, and that governments and stakeholders need new approaches to fisheries management in order to incentivise behaviour that brings social, economic and environmental benefits. In order to achieve this, innovation will be a key aspect of the approach. Intelligent measures are required. Technological electronic means such as sensors appear to be acknowledged as the most effective way in which to ensure quotas are adhered to. Clearly, there is a risk that the discarding could continue illicitly due to various pressures, and this will result in unaccounted for mortality. WWF believe that remote electronic monitoring with cameras and sensors are the most effective means of assessing how measures can be monitored and controlled on the water, with the added benefit that data can be used for multiple purposes, including contributing to and improving confidence in stock assessment or to demonstrate best practice. It also provides a tool with which to support all the operators that are working responsibly and with integrity. But this needs international cooperation. The measures that have allowed the success that our own pelagic fleet has achieved in adhering to quotas needs to be exported. Joint regional agreements are required, especially with countries such as Sweden and Germany, who currently appear to need convincing of the merits of CCTV on board vessels. Mike Park of the Scottish Whitefish Producers Association, which represents 1,200 fishermen, reinforced in last week's meeting how hard the Scottish industry has worked to achieve the quotas so far. Measures such as regional and real-time closures have not been easy for fishermen, but have successfully contributed towards producing the desired results. We hardly need reminding, and indeed the estimable Jamie McGregor has already reminded us earlier on, of how dangerous this occupation or arguably way of life is for those fishermen who brave the elements in the inhospitable North Sea and other waters surrounding our extensive coastline. Their commitment to the industry should not be taken for granted. They have continued through what have been hard times. The fleet has endured many years of restrictions on their fishing, and praise is due for the self-discipline and determination to persevere that so many of our fishermen have demonstrated. And the Cabinet Secretary has achieved much, and I wish him well in the weeks ahead in the fishing talks, especially given the frequent reluctance of UK governments to allow him the not unreasonable privilege of representing Scotland at the top table, despite Scotland's predominance within the UK fishing fleet. It does not seem so long since the Cabinet Secretary said on the 9th of December last year that he was shadowing his fifth UK fishing minister with the expectation of a sixth this year. Sure enough, on the 11th of May 2015, his expectation became a reality with the appointment of George Eustace MP as yet another Minister of State for Farming, Food and the Marine Environment. And I welcome the Scottish Government's endeavours, including the creation of the National Marine Plan, which is allowing an improved framework for management of the competing demands on marine resources that are of such great value to Scotland. Presiding Officer, fish is a great part of a healthy diet, and for consumers to be able to buy more from local shops or supermarkets with a produced in Scotland label is great for customers. And I expect most members celebrated the Marine Conservation Society's announcement in September that cod could once again be eaten as an occasional treat following a recovery in numbers and having been removed from its red list of endangered fish. But we must remind ourselves of the hard work that's been required and that which will need to be continued in order to preserve what has been achieved. Presiding Officer, I commend the Scottish fishing industry and all that they have achieved this year, wish them well for next year, and wish the Cabinet Secretary every success in the weeks ahead. Thank you.
Many thanks, and I now call David Stewart to be followed by Rob Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and apologies to the Chamber for missing an earlier part of the debate as I had a meeting with a minister. Presiding Officer, this is an important debate, as Scotland, as we've heard, is a key player amongst the fishing nations in Europe and accounts for around two-thirds of the total fish caught in the UK. And with a turnover, as we've heard from the Cabinet Secretary, of 514 million and nearly 5,000 fishermen employed on Scottish-based vessels, this is a key economic resource for Scotland generally and the Highlands and Islands and the North East specifically. The EU end-of-year negotiations are, of course, crucial for member states to determine the total allowable catches. The rules around fishing opportunities are, of course, complex, as most things to do with Europe are, but they have, of course, been reformed since 2014 under the principle of maximum sustainable yield. Now, the big picture, Presiding Officer, is, of course, a world where we have a global food shortage, whilst on our own doorstep we have fresh, affordable and varied food stock for both domestic and, crucially, our export markets. And as this year draws to a close, we look to 2016 as a landmark year for the industry as it faces the implementation of the landing obligation or discard ban for white fish. And whilst implementation of the ban will have various positive impacts, such as the including increasing conservation of fish stocks and new quota flexibility for fishermen, It's essential that the discard ban be implemented effectively, efficiently, and in a way that avoids the adverse effects on the industry and especially the workforce. For it's of course the local communities and the hard-working fishermen that provide the backbone of this fishing industry. And as a long-time representative of the Highlands and Islands, I'm well aware of the distinctive traditions, customs and the close-knit communities that the pursuit of fishing has created along the coasts of Scotland. Although the majority of the fishing industry now operates from major harbours with large, efficient fleets, let's not forget about the small coastal communities whose residents have lived with the salt of the sea in their bloods for generations. Over recent years, advances in technology and the demands of the EU have left many of these communities in a state of flux. For example, the Scottish Whitefish Producers Association have made it clear that they're unhappy with the landing obligations and particularly the challenge of implementation, and they're very keen to have a very clear route map outlined until 2019. And as the new landing obligations put in place starting in January 2016, there's still some uncertainties on the horizon for many of our fishermen. And one of the issues that the Scottish Fishermen's Federation has raised is the need for clarity regarding the disposal of unwanted fish landed as a result of the discard ban. The Federation argues that the costly burden of transportation and disposal of the fish will fall upon the fishermen themselves. Accordingly, according to the Federation, this is an undue financial liability that will ultimately cause economic distress through parts of the industry, particularly the smaller coastal communities. And as I stated earlier, it's imperative that the Scottish Government makes plans for a successful and smooth implementation of the landing obligation while carefully recognising the need to protect the interests of our fishermen and our small fishing communities. I think also it's proper that the Government also should have sufficient support measures in place for the fishing community that may have to deal with the transportation and disposal of unmarketable fish. A transitional struggle as this is one of the many reasons for the new European Maritime and Fisheries Fund that many members have referred to. I would welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comments in his wind-up on the new fund, and perhaps I could ask a few questions to the Cabinet Secretary now. What will the total budget be for EMFF? What will the criteria be for successful application? What is the application process? And will there be a matching required to access the funds? When will Marine Scotland publish its guidance? And how will the funds be allocated to Scotland, comparable with other fishing nations? And, Presiding Officer, I'm happy to give way now if the Cabinet Secretary wants to make a first dash on this particular answers.
Cabinet Secretary.
To be invited, I will happily inform David Stewart that the plan is on track at €107 million, which is unfortunately less than Scotland's deserved share of European funds, in my view, but that's what the UK would negotiate and will be open for applications as scheduled, hopefully in January.
David Stewart.
I appreciate the Cabinet Secretary answering an unscheduled intervention, perhaps in setting a new procedure for our Parliament. But here in Scotland, our fishing communities often exist in a fragile balance with onshore and offshore livelihoods at stake, requiring any significant changes to be viewed with careful and critical eye. So when looking towards the future of the industry, we know that sustainable development fisheries is beneficial environmentally, socially and economically, but we must proceed with caution. Our fishermen, of course, are some of the most resilient workers in the whole of Scotland and beyond. Whether that adversity stems from the high seas or new mandated regulations from the EU, we know that Scottish fishermen will rise to the challenge. But the challenge for the future, Presiding Officer, is the level of funding for marine research, the enforcement and monitoring of the landing obligation, and how we gear up the new EMFF process to aid our fishermen in this transition period. Thank you.
Many thanks. And just for the record, I think the presiding officers would prefer to stick with the traditional procedures. I now call Rob Gibson, who's our last open debate speaker. I have a little bit of extra time, Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, presiding officer. I don't know whether my voice has got extra time or not, but we'll see. Presiding officer, this debate is prefigured by the fact that the fishing industry in Scotland is a very strong part of our economy. James Jack of Dunure on the Clyde says in the Fishing News that it is worth seven times more per head of population to Scotland than to the rest of the UK. And with 70% of the landings in the UK, that means that this industry in Scotland is one of our key platforms for support of our rural coastal areas and the many downstream activities that are involved. But the potential for making a sustainable fishing industry is obviously the main source of the debate today. And I'm delighted to hear about the strength of some of the major stocks that we've been debating. But I'd like to concentrate on one of the ways of monitoring what is being caught and take some approach with the WWF idea about remote electronic monitoring of cameras and sensors and say, I think that we've got to see the scientists and the monitoring working in partnership with the fishermen themselves so that there can be confidence between the catchers and the regulators, because remote electronic monitoring is all very well, but we must have an ability of the fishers themselves to confirm that they are a part of this process and not something that is just being monitored separately, because trust and confidence have got to be built on that basis. And so I'd like to see, with that caveat from some of the speakers, some more confidence in our fishers. With regard to the European Maritime and Fisheries Fund, I'm glad that's been mentioned a couple of times, and indeed we passed the secondary legislation in our committee the week before last. And we noted at the time that it was important to many fragile coastal communities. In that regard, I wonder if I can ask the Cabinet Secretary whether in correspondence with him, and whether he can mention now, that the harbour at Kinlochbervie, which requires modernisation, which was built at the same time as many of the other West Coast ports, can receive attention from the European Maritime and Fisheries Fund in order to make modernised facilities that would allow it to compete on a level playing field with other neighbouring ports such as Loch Inver and so on, because it would be important to that very fragile community that that were possible. Now, on the wider seafood sector, I'd like to talk a bit about the fact that as a food, we've got an awful lot of excellent seafood, which we, as somebody said, David Stewart said, I think, presiding officer, that the important export trade. But we have to ask ourselves, are the fishers getting any more because the fish is eaten in France or if it were sold here? And the answer is, at this stage, no, because it's the middlemen right throughout. And I'm not looking at Christian Allard particularly and mention France. But I am going to say that at the same time, we know that the trade in lobsters at Christmas in France and Spain and Portugal are a very important trade for that part of the seafood sector, and that they, I hope, will have a stronger trade than in the period after the crash, and that there will be something which they've been collecting lobsters all year to serve at this time will have that potential. But if we're to look at more of our fish being consumed in Scotland, then the concept of the Scottish Government's approach to becoming a good food nation by 2025 is going to have to make it more possible for many more people to eat fish which is caught in our waters and sold by our fishermen. It's not very many of us who get to the fish van in our village on a Tuesday when you think about the number of people who might buy fish in a supermarket that is in no way as fresh as the fish van of Bell's from Scrabster. And so how are we going to maximise that? The importance of these things has to be carried through. On the wider seafood element as well, I wonder if I might comment, because aquaculture is a part of this, about the concerning situation where the Food and Drugs Administration in America has given the go-ahead for a GM salmon, which is going to take a couple of years perhaps to develop. We're not quite sure whether it's just a kind of a cat's paw to try and get protein food for people introduced in other forms. But at the same time, the potential for the loss of any salmon like that into the wild is something which we've been predicting is unacceptable in many ways and is something that's got to be stopped. I must return finally to the problems nearer shore and to echo comments that have been made by my colleague Ian Blackford and our concerns about the extension of the Butec torpedo range near Kyle. It's important.
Would you like to pause for a second, Mr. Gibson?
I don't have any water. I think it would be better.
Just pause briefly. I'll come back to you in a second.
Christian Allard. For the member of taking an intervention, I just wanted to clarify a point when he talked about middlemen. Fish processors are not middlemen. They are very much part integral of the industry. And without them, the fish will be shipped straight abroad and be processed abroad. Let's not forget that fish processors are one integral part of the industry, not only this, but they provide a lot of employment.
Rob Gibson, and I'll give you some extra time.
Thank you very much. It's kind of you to do so. Yes, I agree with you that that's the downstream socio-economic effects that we have to take on board. To return to Butec, there's a desperate need to have a talk between Fishers, the NEFROC Fishers, the MOD and Kinetic, the people who conduct torpedo testing. And at the moment, there isn't a socio-economic study about the impacts of the quadrupling of the size of the torpedo range. And that's a key sector in safe waters in winter where NEFROC Fishers can fish. So we'd be asking this government to monitor that and to make sure, as in everything, that we take forward this policy as best we can for Scotland and the fishing community. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now turn to closing speeches and a call on Tavish Scott. 6 minutes, please.
Well, that was a tour de force. I can only congratulate Mr. Gibson on getting through that and to Christine Allard for the lengthy. I thought that intervention was a bit short by your standards, Christine. Could have kept that going for a minute or two longer. But nevertheless, let me pick up one of Rob Gibson's points, presiding officer, because it also refers to Claudia Beamish's interesting observations about climate change in the context of the industry we're discussing today. Paris takes place or is taking place, so it's entirely appropriate to consider that. But the Shetland Fishermen Yearbook 2016 actually has a whole section on the carbon footprint of the industry, which I thought is worth contemplating in the context of the remarks that Mr. Gibson and Claudia Beamish made. A study there by the Marine Centre in Scalloway of the pelagic industry has found that just 0.41 tonnes of carbon dioxide equivalent is released into the atmosphere for every tonne of fish caught, which compares to 10 tonnes for beef, 11 for lamb, 4 for chicken and 3 for pork. Now, I suppose the point really here is that the carbon footprint, therefore, of the mackerel fishery is 8.5 times lower than the lowest scoring meat product and 47 times lower than the highest. And I think if we're making the argument about the carbon footprint of any industry, it's worth recognising therefore what fishing and the fishing industry does in that context. Mr. Gibson also rightly mentioned food security, and it does strike me, in that context, that that fishing can play an important and significant role in that, not least of which because it's the biggest protein producer for the world, about 17% according to the United Nations, and the benefits on health in particular are well understood and well versed. Just two or three other points I want to make in that context. Again, I thought the points that Margaret McDougall made about the mackerel industry's export profile is important. Sadly, it's not just the Russian market that was closed because of sanctions. It's also the Ukrainian market, which certainly used to be very significant both for the northeast and for Shetland catch. That was closed, of course, because there's armed conflict there and there's basically no hard currency. And the implications for that were very significant indeed for quite a number of our export businesses. As Margaret McDougall rightly observed, the pursuit of Africa, which of course is not a new market for our pelagic industry, and the Far East, which is more so, simply because the Norwegians have always had such a very good grip of that particular market. But the point is well made, and it's important in the future in terms of how the industry develops, and also how, given the quota point the Minister made, how price doesn't collapse if the market pressures are considerable. In other words, there's too much supply and not enough demand, then it's very important that the Minister brings all powers he can to bear, including Scottish Development International, to assist the industry in that particular area overseas. I just also wanted to touch on the point that Stuart Stevenson and Margaret McDougall both made about science. Indeed, I think other members have raised this as well during the debate. There are, as I mentioned earlier on, data-deficient stocks. The important point about those, for example, on lemon sole, is while they're not the highest volume or the highest value landings for our industry, the stronger the science is, the easier it is to win these arguments with the European Commission, and the easier it is to avoid the... Just 2 seconds. The easier it is to avoid the precautionary principle applying, which, while we may all, of course, agree with the principles of it, is never that easy to sell to the industry. Have a give way.
Stuart Stevenson.
Will the member agree with me that often the quotas for these very small stocks might be the choke quotas that prevent the, in a mixed fishery, the catching of large stocks?
Absolutely, that is exactly the point, and it is the point that brings one inevitably to the discard ban and the importance of these issues being resolved as the 2016 goes forward. Now, I might just ask the Cabinet Secretary in his wind-up if he can just clarify what he expects the role to be of Marine Scotland in conjunction with the industry, because the reality of this is it will be an ongoing issue. It will be the details of it will be really important to work through, and those will not all be done by the end of this year, because they can't be, simply because more species are to be introduced, as he mentioned, at the end of 2016 and the end of 2017 as well. So an understanding for Parliament in how his department plans to take that forward would be helpful for all of us who meet with the industry and represent them. And on that point, I do take Stuart Stevenson and Christian Allard's point about the Scottish Fishermen's Federation. It would be useful, of course, to have a briefing for all of us. There may be things going on in the background that I'm not aware of, but let me also gently say it doesn't help when some people attack them personally, as happened in the debate last year. But nevertheless, they make a fair point, and it would be helpful in that regard. I didn't quite worry so much about not getting a foul briefing. There were a few years ago that there was some years back where we all used to quote foul briefings, the debate was much more about a rather more extreme form of fisheries management, which was completely withdrawing from the common fisheries policy. It's funny how times move on, and that doesn't feature so often now. But nevertheless, the importance here is to make sure that MSPs are able not to just consider rightly, for example, the wildlife, the WWF submission, which is important, but also the thoughts of the industry directly. And in that regard, members have made important points. I want to also just reflect the very strong argument that both Angus MacDonald and Graham Pearson made about a level playing field.
Briefly, if you could, please.
And in that case, I'll just reflect that was a very strong point, Presiding Officer. And just simply wind up by recognising the challenges the Minister has, I think particularly on the discard ban. I think the December Fisheries Council, as he has observed, nearly takes care of itself this year, all but for the access discussions about mackerel in Copenhagen next week. But the strongest and most difficult issue we all have to contemplate is the discard ban and the importance, therefore, of a sustainable use of fishing opportunities, achieving the economic sustainability for coastal communities and the contribution to food security that we all require.
Many thanks. I'm afraid I've noticed that Graham Pearson, who participated in the debate, is missing from the chamber. I don't have an explanation. I'd be grateful if one would be forthcoming from Mr. Pearson. I call on Jamie McGregor up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. McGregor.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to close what I think has been a very useful debate with some very good speeches across the chamber. And I thank members such as Tavish Scott and Stuart Stevenson for their very kind remarks. I never knew they cared so much. But it's very, very touching, and I'm grateful. Members on all sides have rightly referred to the positive news in relation to the IC's advice for many of the stocks most important to Scotland, including North Sea cod, which is at its highest level for a decade, thank goodness. And I want to emphasise again that it's thanks to the efforts of our Scottish fishermen that these stocks are in a healthy position. They've made many sacrifices over the last decade and a half, and introduce more conservation measures, be it real-time closures, adaptations to fishing gear or spatial management, than any other fishing fleet in the whole of Europe. And we should commend them for that. They've done a great job. The biggest issue of this debate has understandably been the impending phased introduction from next year of the discard ban on the whitefish sector. While the discard ban in the pelagic sector has been relatively easy to manage due to the nature of the fishery, because pelagic species tend to swim together, unlike demersal stocks, who swim different stocks swim together, the challenges of meeting the obligation in a mixed whitefish fishery governed by quotas and relative stability are very hard indeed. And in fact, it was Ian Gatt of the pelagic fisheries who told me that. And he said, it's been not so difficult for us, but it's going to be much more difficult for the demersal sector. And there are real risks along the way. Well, I welcome the general consensus understanding in this debate of the need for an uplift in quotas. That is fundamental, but it's not the solution in itself. Like Tavish Scott, I mentioned in my opening speech the need for a truly consistent approach across all vessels fishing in the EU waters in terms of enforcement and compliance, and this is absolutely vital. I also agree with Tavish Scott again when he argued that there must be no resistance to the application of flexibilities and no gold plating of regulations to the disadvantage of our whitefish fishermen. Claudia Beamish referred to the European Maritime Fisheries Fund, and I agree it should be utilised appropriately to support our fishermen in the transition period to the full discard ban. And this is a point that my colleague Dr. Ian Duncan, MEP, has made many times. And it was, of course, Ian Duncan who inserted the clause into the text of the relevant European law on discards that said that member states should have in place measures to facilitate their storage or for finding outlets for undersized fish, such as support for investment in the construction and adaptation of landing sites and shelters, or support for investments to add value to fisheries products. Now, Rob Gibson talked about investment in Kinloch Bervey, which I think is an example of the point of my amendment in today's debate. And I will reiterate my previous comments about the importance of achieving an equitable deal for the pelagic fishermen in terms of mackerel and blue whiting quotas with Norway and the Faroes. Quite simply, the Faroese are catching too much in our waters and we are not benefiting in return from access to their waters. We need to support our pelagic fishermen and the important processing facilities dependent on their catch. The market is already challenging for them, given the ongoing Russian-EU trade dispute, the devaluation of the Ukrainian currency, which has already been mentioned, and the significant currency import problems with Nigeria since the oil economy crash. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I again call on the Cabinet Secretary to look at the specific additional support for the demersal sector to help it meet what will be a profound challenge in meeting the discard ban both from next year and in transition to the full ban in 2019. And on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, I wish him and his team well for the negotiations in Brussels and the ongoing negotiations with Norway and the Faroese, which are so important too. And I wish him all success in achieving maximum catching opportunity for the Scottish fishing fleet, because thereby he will be supporting sustainable economic activity, communities all over Scotland, and food security as well. I have no problem with the Liberal or Labour amendments, and I hope that the Cabinet Secretary will see fit to support my Conservative one. Thank you.
Many thanks, Mr. McGregor. And I now call on Claudia Beamish. 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This has been a wide-ranging debate, and we have been able to explore the issues together across the Chamber. At the end of our year of Scottish food and drink, I want to turn for a few moments to the quest for fresh, affordable food
And I'd like to highlight Scottish Wildlife's new publication. And Idea 39 reads, to inspire a step change in consumer habits to eliminate demand for unsustainably sourced seafood. And each section of the booklet has a talking point. For marine and coastal, it reads, what is the most effective way of changing consumer habits with regard to sustainable seafood? There are many fresh ideas from this afternoon's debate and beyond. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to reassure the Chamber that taking this forward is not siloed either in Scottish Food and Drink or elsewhere, and this is not a criticism of any of the organisations involved, but that there is a collective drive to ensure that those who sell our seafood and that they ensure wise purchase and promote effectively so that we know what is on offer. And also, interestingly, Scottish Seafood, which I understand is wholesale facing, has a handy seasonal guide to sustainable fish eating. And that's for international buyers and for chefs and the media. And I learnt quite a lot just from the A4, the sort of perfect briefing for MSPs with their busy lives. I want also to highlight in terms of jobs, looking at the onshore benefits that arise from the fishing industry, at the medicinal properties of fish. And the cod recovery plan has perhaps given more confidence for those who know about sustainable fisheries to take cod liver oil, helping the heart, vitamin D for the immune systems, and importantly at this time of year. And it also contributes to normal bones and muscle function, personally quite useful for me at the moment. I'm only glad that the modern capsule form bought by my partner rather than the teaspoon, which was force-fed to me as a child, is actually, what I'm being given at the moment. Also, fish oils are used in the beauty, skincare, and nail product industries. And I hope the Cabinet Secretary agrees that checking out the opportunities of sustainable harvest, process, and marketing of medicinal and beauty products as well from fish and nature more widely, it's an opportunity for jobs that Scotland should not miss. Thanks to my colleague Dave Stewart for his perspective from the Highlands and Islands, rightly paying tribute to the resilience of the fishing industry and our small communities, who, as he said, have lived with the salt of the sea in their blood. I echo his call to the Scottish Government to commit to the European Maritime Fisheries Fund and make it available to all those in this transition time, whether for transport or for distribution or for diversification. The only way to develop any industry sustainably is to entrench its future in science and research, as we've heard from a number of members this afternoon. And as Margaret McDougall has said, we need investment in research to clearly monitor progress and assess changing needs for ecosystems and for industry. Will the Cabinet Secretary consider fighting to direct more funding to Marine Scotland to ensure an evidence-based approach? Good luck with that, Cabinet Secretary. Tavish Scott pointed out as I understand, the fishing industry has 8.5 times lower than the lowest carbon footprint in the meat industry. And that is an interesting figure indeed. And according to research of Bloom, who I referred to in my opening remarks, the Northeast Atlantic Sea has a greater biodiversity than all the rainforests of the world put together. An ecosystem approach, I'm not going to take an intervention, I've got very little time, thank you. The ecosystem approach is essential to the future of our fisheries. In my speech on fisheries in December of 2011, I welcomed the staged implementation of the discard ban as it was being planned. And Graham Pearson and many others in this debate have exposed the fragile nature of the future of our fisheries and the utter necessity of ensuring that the landing obligation is proportionately planned, managed and monitored. And I'm grateful to rely on him as a colleague in the Justice Brief to explore the issues surrounding compliance with the landing obligation. As a ban encapsulates demersal fish as well, there are a number of questions which the Cabinet Secretary will need to address in the negotiations, which many members have raised this afternoon and are indeed very complex in a mixed fishery. Will the Cabinet Secretary seek a pan-European consensus on the rules of enforcement, as argued by Tavish Scott and Angus MacDonald and others? May I too add my wishes to Jamie McGregor and recognise his significant contribution in fisheries debates and indeed in fisheries management, not just on the West Coast. And I want also to thank Angus MacDonald for the meeting that was hosted here in the Scottish Parliament with the Scottish Whitefish Producers Association, and also with Marks and Spencer, obviously at the consumer end, and the Scottish Government, organised by WWF Scotland. And I believe this is testament to the sort of partnership working that we need in the future here in Scotland. I wish the Cabinet Secretary well in the complexity of the EU negotiations in Brussels and in the other negotiations which have been raised by members in relation to the Faroes and Norway and Iceland in the near future. And I hope he will indeed be able to take a leading role in those negotiations within the UK delegation. Good luck, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you.
Many thanks. And I now call on Richard Lockhead to wind up the debate. Cabinet Secretary, you have until 5 o'clock.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you very much to all members for their contributions as we prepare to go to our key annual negotiations in Brussels the week after next. I should start by referring to Jamie McGregor, given that we all don't know if we'll be in the respective seats following May's elections. Jamie has voluntarily given up his seat in terms of May's elections. And even though I can't support his amendment today, I'm afraid, and even though I can't claim to have his knowledge of prawns, and even though we often disagree on some of the big issues of the day, I do want to pay tribute to Jamie McGregor, because we always know that he does have the fishing industry's interests at heart and has made many fine contributions to our annual fishing debates over the years since 1999. I was going to refer to Jamie as an old cod, like an old cod back in 1999. Not that many colleagues, and many of them were discarded in subsequent years by human intervention. He survived to 2015, but I'm not quite sure that his parties had the same kind of recovery as the COD has today as well. But you have survived. You are a survivor, and you're here as having been part of the 99 intake like myself, and I wish Jamie all the best for the future. And I'm sure you'll continue to take a close interest in fisheries. In terms of the other amendments and the other parties, we are content to support the Labour Party's amendments tabled by Claudia Beamish. Unfortunately, we can't support Tavish Scott's amendment. I take on board that many of his comments we could support, but in terms of securing an uplift in quota allocations for species covered by the introduction of discard ban, of course we have to pay attention to the science, and in terms of some species there will be more discards, therefore more of a justification for an uplift than perhaps others. So we have to take that into account. Therefore, we cannot support Tavish Scott's amendment today. Since it's Jamie McGregor, yes.
Jamie McGregor.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention. And while I see that he's not going to support my amendment, I wonder if he would not admit that the insertion of the clause by Dr. Ian Duncan referring to extra support for the transition of the discard ban was a good thing, because I don't know if he thinks it's a good thing or not, but all the fishermen think it's a good thing.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we don't often agree with the Conservative Party south of the border on many things, but in terms of our interpretation of Ian Duncan's amendment to that particular regulation, we share the UK Government's interpretation of that, which it's not incumbent on the Member States to give any more support than what they're already giving. And indeed, in Scotland's support, I do believe that we have a good plan in hand to work with the industry to make sure they can get through the discard ban. I may refer to that in my forthcoming remarks. Many members, of course, have made good comments and referred to the contribution of the fishing industry to Scotland, and of course the fact that many fishermen have made the ultimate sacrifice to bring fish to our tables. And indeed, in the 21st century, our fishermen are not just fishermen. They have to be experts in paperwork. They have to be conservationists as well as fishermen. They also have to share space at sea with other users and other industries, not least the renewable energy sector. And in terms of marine protected areas, we have to also have spatial management in relation to protecting our precious seabed features. And that's why the Scottish Government are implementing a network of 30 marine protected areas, and have considered very, very carefully the economic impact on Scotland's fishing communities as we've done so.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking an intervention. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the right balance has been found in order to move the marine protected area plans forward in terms of the socio-economic and environmental protection aims?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, whilst I've listened very closely to recent representations from particularly the Clyde and West Coast fishing communities, I do think we have struck a fair balance, but of course we will make our final announcements in a few days' time. But it's clear there's divided opinion within even the fishing industry itself, because we're talking about one part of the fishing industry who've expressed concern over some of the boundaries of the MPAs. I want to turn quickly to some of the issues mentioned by members during the debate. Firstly, Rob Gibson referred to the proposal by the Minister of Defence to extend the torpedo testing range between Skye and the mainland. And I just want to assure Rob Gibson and other members that I'm following very closely the consultation process being conducted by the MOD. I heard it firsthand from some fishermen at a recent inshore fisheries conference about their concerns about the potential impact in small fishing vessels in the area, and I very much urge the Minister of Defence to take full account of the responses expressed by local fishermen in that part of Scotland. Claudia Beamish mentioned two or three issues. I can't cover all the issues she mentioned, but in terms of one also mentioned by Dave Stewart, the future of the European Maritime Fisheries Fund. As I said before, that is opening in January for applications. There will be €107 million in that fund, taking into account match funding from the Scottish Government and the European element as well. And importantly, in response to some of the comments, there will be a lot of support within that to help the industry adapt to the discard bans in Scottish waters in terms of better selectivity and adopting other measures. Dave Stewart also mentioned what's the position of the disposal of unwanted fish. The position on the disposal of unwanted fish in terms of the discard bans is that responsibility for storing and transporting unwanted catch lies with the vessel. And that's what the regulation says, and that's the position for all member states. But as I've just said, the European Maritime Fisheries Fund will provide a financial mechanism to support fishermen in that area if required. But I should emphasise that in the first year of the whitefish discard bans 2016, we anticipate the unwanted catch to be very small at Scotland's quaysides. So clearly this is an ongoing issue for 2017 and 18 and 19, but that is hopefully the situation for 2016. In terms of deep sea trawling, I should say to Claudia Beamish that Scotland currently is leading the way in brokering a European agreement on deep sea trawling, which protects, of course, vulnerable marine ecosystems and the species where they are found. It's a very difficult issue, but we are paying close attention to that. In terms of Tavish Scott's comment about taking forward the discard bans, we will, for beyond 2016, which he was asking about, work with the regionalisation of the common fisheries policy, so our neighbouring states will all be working together, and likewise with our industries. So many of the decisions have still to be taken on what species will be included and how they will be included for 2017, 18, 19, but I assure him that we will be standing up for Scotland's interests in those matters. Understandably, much of the comment today has been about the impact of the discard bans in Scottish and European waters. As I said before, given that globally 7 million tonnes of fish was estimated to be discarded in 2005, which is one of the most recent estimates available, it is no wonder that public opinion, political opinion, scientific opinion, industry opinion believes that is a chronic waste of a good quality food resource and a quality waste of what should be a good economic contribution to Scotland and Europe's economies. Therefore, it is a no-brainer we are tackling discards in Scottish and European waters. But we should take the opportunity to congratulate the Scottish industry on the fact they have taken huge steps to already reduce the amount of fish discards in our waters. Scottish discards of North Sea cod reduced by nearly half since 2007, from 51% to 24%. And 16% of whitefish caught by Scottish fishermen in 2012 were discarded, compared to 47% in 2007. So they have been making the utmost effort to reduce discards. But as I said in my opening remarks, there's still a long way to go, and public opinion wants to see an end to the discarding of good quality fish dead overboard into our seas, which is a complete waste and of no use to anyone. And that's why we certainly support that in this country and will work with our industry to make it happen. There is no bigger illustration, however, of the industry's progress in recent years than the recovery of North Sea cod. It is incredible to think the North Sea cod stock is now three times the size it was in 2006. I repeat that. The North Sea cod stock is now three times the size it was in 2006. It's only a couple of years since one Sunday newspaper famously emblazoned in the front page there was only a handful of cod left in the North Sea, which led to a lot of consternation in the fishing industry in Scotland and beyond. But here we are in 2015, and it's three times the level it was in 2006. And it's fantastic that now our fishermen are preparing to apply for marine accredited stewardship for cod stocks, which will open up new markets in the UK and throughout the rest of the world as well. And that's also against the backdrop going into this negotiation of 10 of our 15 key whitefish stocks in line for significant quota increases. Normally, we go into these talks trying to fight off big cuts in days at sea or an avalanche of quota cuts, yet this year we're going in with the prospect of getting quota increases for 10 out of Scotland's key whitefish species. So I think in anyone's book, that is really good news and huge progress. As I reach a conclusion, I just want to say that this debate today has been about our fishermen. It's also about the fish processing jobs. It's about the painters, the shipyard workers, the electricians, the software companies, those that build and maintain the vessels. It's also about the net makers, the workers in the harbour cafes, the lorry drivers, the fuel suppliers, and so on. It's about everyone in Scotland whose livelihood depends on having healthy fish stocks in our seas and an active fishing industry. It's also about the multi-million pound pelagic boats based in the northeast of Scotland or in Shetland, down to the one-man creel boats in our inshore waters as well. And most importantly, it's about ensuring that future generations can benefit from having rich fish stocks in our waters and access to those stocks through accessing quota and being able to have a vessel. So this is about the future. Implementing discard bans in 2016 will be tough, it will be challenging, but it's the right thing to do for our fishing industry, it's the right thing to do for fisheries conservation, and it's the right thing to do for Scotland, and I'll fight to get the best possible deal for Scotland's fishing communities the week after next at the annual fishing negotiations in Brussels. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on sea fisheries and end year negotiations. The next item of business is decision time. There are five questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion number 1495.